off the lights of the car ahead. For the moment, they're just sitting in the queue, but you can see even at this reduced speed how much spray there is. Depending on the cloud cover, the light changes at different parts of the circuit. And we're riding on board number 66 BMW at the moment, with Matthias Lauda at the wheel. And that car ran strongly in the first hour of the race, but has dropped away after a couple of slow pit stops and an extra pit stop on top as well to do some tyre changing. And that is a pool where you can see that it's very wet indeed. The drivers want to paddle their way through that long left-hander. Now the race director having brought the safety car onto the circuit as soon as the rain started to fall heavily, bunching everybody up, but reducing, of course, therefore, the risk to the drivers. We also, a few hours ago, had a rather sizable accident for Philippe Salini, whose Porsche aquaplaned into the barrier coming out of Blanchimont. He is out of the car, but a bit sore, and has been taken to hospital in Verviers for x-rays. But that car is also a very badly damaged Porsche and is out of the race. But the good news is that Philippe Salini out of the car, and it bruised and battered, is otherwise okay. So as the cars continue to circulate behind the safety car, this the 64th running of the Spa 24 Hours. It began in 1924, and in recent times, with SRO working with the event organisers, it has become a GT race. But for many, many years, it was a key part, a focal point, really, of the European Touring Car Championship season. There's Mike Heseman's there, who is a double winner of the event, sprints across the pit lane to find out how his car is getting on. It was delayed early in the race, thanks to a throttle cable that snapped. It has been since brought back into the race, and it is 28th now with Bert Longchamp at the wheel. The car has done 97 laps. The leader is on lap 102. It is a long way back. It may luck into places and gain a few places on pace as well before the end of 24 hours. But such is the competitive nature of the championship and of the GT3 concept these days that losing even a lap, never mind multiple laps, really does spell disaster, particularly in a race round here. A big crowd, as ever, on hand for the Spa 24 Hours, some of whom now drifting for shelter, but also to the concerts. Faithless is playing as well this evening, got local bands, but Faithless, fronted by Maxi Jazz, himself an enthusiastic racer, both initially in Ford Fiestas, but most recently in the Porsche Carrera Cup GB. He's here, he was on the grid, camera around his neck, and was certainly revelling in the opportunity to be up close and personal with cars, one or two of which I think he might own, but which he might aspire to own. Big petrol head is Maxi Jazz, and somebody who might be tempted back into racing perhaps before much longer. So two notified retirements, the 87 Porsche after its accident, and also the 35 Nissan, disappointingly, after it suffered the electrical dramas. And that was a car that Jan Mardenborough had been driving most recently and going strongly in. And that's the mood in the camp, in fact, looking into the RJN Motorsport pit box. In the pit lane there is number six, Tom Christensen. You can see the rain falling. Tom having his Spa 24-hour debut. And it's a real shame that as soon as he gets into the car, he goes into it knowing that he's got a pretty bleak chance of a good result out of this. Yes, the car certainly will gain places over the course of 24 hours, but no longer pitching for a win. And for the moment, engine remains off, giving the signal to fire up. Two-part pit stops, refueling first of all, and then if you want to do anything else like change tyres or work on the car, that has to come within the second part of the pit stop. Audi getting itself to the far end of the F1 pits. New tyres are going to go on, new wets. So as soon as the car is released, it's away and it turns through the inside of La Source, but you can't rejoin the track from there. You have to go all the way through what's called the endurance pits, and then the cars climb up through Eau Rouge, and then when you're onto the Camel Straight, that's the blend line back onto the circuit. So Tom Christensen then gets away and paddles his way down the pit lane. You're on board with him now through the right-hander, and then doesn't burst back onto the circuit. Has to go down through the endurance pits. See how dark it is becoming at Spa. Rain very hard at turn one, according to the race director, informing the teams. They don't know, they're stuck in one place. He's getting reports from around the circuit from the marshals. Down past the grandstands on the left, the pits on the right, past the old race control building. And then when he gets to the bottom of the hill, crosses the white line, can accelerate uphill and rejoin. There's the safety car, one of two, in fact. Like Le Mans, two safety cars are used for the lap around here. And you can see just how bad the rain is and how bad the standing water is around the circuit. Now down in the pit lane, trying to keep dry, is Hayley Coxon. She is with Vincent Voss.
Vincent, you're currently leading the race here at your home track. You got to be happy with that.
Yeah, I mean, so far, but I mean, now we are chasing the 6-hour point, and but the race is still going to be quite long. And as you see, it's very, very difficult conditions, and it's a hard choice for, well, not at the moment, but it was a hard choice for tires. No, I think we are on the right one, and we cross finger.
And you're happy with the way the car's performing here?
Yeah, the two cars did quite well for the start of the race. We had unlucky pit stop with the number two car, but okay, we will catch up.
First and fourth is good though for the team for this current position.
Yeah, for sure. At the moment we are leading, and the other car is third or fourth. So we're quite happy with this, and we have to keep, and we have to catch the 6-hour point. That's very important.
Thank you, Vincent.
The 6 hours that Vincent Voss refers to is that there are points within the championship awarded at the 6-hour and the 12-hour mark, as well as at the end of the 24 hours. Nothing at 18, but you get half points at 6 and half points at 12 hours, and therefore that, again, is key for the championship. And it was doing so well in last year's Spa 24 hours that really did help Greg Franchi with a huge haul of points over the weekend to take the title. Well, he is no longer an Audi driver. This year he is at Vita 4-1, driving in the number 66 BMW, and that car is currently in 11th place, having been battling hard early on. It's currently shown as two laps down as the car's there for a rather brighter part of the circuit into the bus stop. But it's also a section of the circuit that's illuminated because of the pit lane, so it's doing a slightly false situation. In terms of how long cars have spent in the pit lane, you can see that the number one race leading car, 8.5 minutes, give or take, had to make an extra pit stop just after Stefan Rotelli took over to come in for wets, whereas the number three BMW has had over 9.5 minutes, in fact, in the pit lane, and only just under at 7.5 minutes, and only four pit stops also for the number 16 second place Audi. And that's becoming a real threat for honours. The number 16 car is Frank Stippler, René Rast and Andrea Piccini. Frank Stippler, former DTM racer who won the Nürburgring 24 hours this year. René Rast, very much a star in the Porsche Super Cup, double champion. And Andrea Piccini, who was a part of the WRT team last year but also drove for them at Silverstone this season, so he's got recent experience about it, and that's key because they're using one of the LMS Ultra cars, whereas it was the original R8 LMS last year, the Ultra new for this year. A lot more downforce, improved in various areas, and so a car with a big step forward, and Piccini's recent experience is very useful. This is the fastest ice cream van at the circuit, the Beach Dean Ice Cream Aston Martin. And by the look of it, it is Mr. Beach Dean himself, Andrew Howard, getting into the car. John Gore was going great guns with that early on, and Phil Drybow brought it in 22nd place. Now, having talked about René Rast being a real star in Porsches, he's in an Audi this weekend. Not just that, he's in the pit lane. So too is Hayley Coxon.
René, you guys have certainly had an impressive move through the traffic here today so far. What are your hopes for the rest of the race?
My hopes are obviously that we finish the race first. I mean, it's very important to just do what we ever do, racing, and we hope we can continue like we do at the moment. Very important to avoid crashes, to avoid mistakes. We did so far. I mean, we are in second place at the moment. And yeah, it would be nice if we could go on the podium tomorrow.
And have you been enjoying racing here at Spa?
Yeah, it's my first time. And it was my first stint just 1 hour ago. And I enjoyed it very, very much. And I'm very pleased with the car at the moment. And I'm looking forward for the next hours.
Thank you.
So René Rast looking forward to the remainder of the race. As you can see, some cars making pit stops. People heading down the pit lane. And if they do so, the race leader car, Christopher Husser at the wheel of it, ahead now of Andrea Piccini. And in third place is Maxime Martin. The number three BMW was the car that dominated the early part of the race, led the first 4 hours. But at the end of the fifth hour, it's an Audi that gets itself up to the top of the classification. The Vita for One Team Italy squad going to work in the pit lane, refueling Ferraris. And we've also got number two Marco Bonanomi making his way down the pit lane. And that's a car that's just come from fourth place. There it is, in fact, number two, and you can see again just how wet it is. Hits the stop board, and the fuel goes in first of all. Engineers will work out whether it needs new tyres. Well, they're standing by ready to put a new set of wets onto the car. The number of sets of tyres you can use during the course of the race is unlimited, but there, I suspect, might be a finite number of wets that Michelin has brought, so they don't want to get through all of them. Although the weather forecast for tomorrow is better. Forecast for tomorrow is dry and sunny. This looks a bit high-tech, this pit stop. Hammer has now been brought out to the 57 Ferrari. Jonathan Hershey having brought the car in. New tyres going on to Marco Bonanomi Audi. Some danger of losing the pace now to Louis Machiels, number 52. Machiels having taken over from Alessandro Pierguidi in the AF course of Ferrari. Right, back into the race goes number two. Leaves the first part of the pit lane through the hairpin at Nassau, drops downhill through the endurance pits, and only at the end of that can he accelerate away back to a proper race pace. There's the United Autosports Audi number 23 in the pit lane that Mark Blundell started in the race. Gave the car then to Mark Patterson. Richard Mines did the third stint, and Alain Lee has brought the car in just recently. His annual trip to the Spa 24 Hours, his annual visit to the Blancpain Endurance Series as well. And the car in 32nd place, the United Autosports team running just one car this weekend, and, as you would have noticed, Audi, not the two McLarens that it was running earlier on in the season. A complete change of focus by the team means that it'll be the McLarens now in British GT, and whether or not United Autosports will do the remaining two Blancpain rounds after this is perhaps a little bit doubtful, but wanting to go well in the Pro-Am Cup this weekend. Now, cars being held there at the end of the pit lane until the next line has come through behind the safety car, and that is the scene at the bus stop as the safety car brings the train through, or two safety cars to be fair, and the first train about to make its way through the bus stop. Now, the race director in the past, when we had an earlier safety car situation on a similar vein because of the bad weather, when things had become a bit safer, was content to instruct the safety car to increase its speed and therefore get the drivers used to going at a quicker pace around the circuit and therefore helping them to generate warmth into the tyres. I would imagine he will do the same again, but we're a fair way off that happening. I think certainly no messages on the timing screen for the teams to suggest that's anywhere near happening. So it is going to be a while yet, I think, before we can go back to racing proper. Another car that was going strongly earlier on but has fallen back into 17th place is the number 8 Porsche, which was started by Uwe Alts and then became Christian Menzel. Now is Mike Stürsberg, who I think we'll admit he's not as quick as the other two, but that car down in 17th. So again, all part of the fascination of this championship is that because of the way that Pro-Am works out, you inevitably end up with a car with one or two really quick drivers, less quick amateurs against them, and it's trying to match the combination of drivers as best you can to get the good result. This is a car I think that will get a good result because you've got Nick Homerson and Louis Machiels, who are quick amateurs, with Andrea Bertolini and Alessandro Pierguidi, who are quick pro drivers. There in the pit lane is number 16 Andrea Piccini, who has come in, and there in the other pit lane is the Alfab Audi from the Swedish GT Championship, having work done on it. Away goes number 16, so Andrea Piccini rejoins. There is 52. That's been in for a while, hasn't it, now? And Louis Machiels, who brought the car in, is still there, but they've been working at the back of the car, and that is one we need to investigate, because the car could lose, as a consequence of that pit stop, its Pro-Am Cup lead to number 5 being shown as Nico Verdonk at the wheel. So 52 is one that needs investigation. The AF Corsa Ferrari rejoining, but a longish pit stop for that car. So as the teams toil away in less than ideal conditions in the pit rain, in the pit lane I should say, the pit rain is perhaps more apt because it's filling up, particularly at the bottom of the hill. There you can see cars leaving, crossing the timing beam, powering uphill, but at Eau Rouge, that's where standing water is often a problem. It's not that bad compared to how it was earlier, when we had water almost hiding the kerbing. It's certainly better than it was in the first downpour of the race. It's particularly dark out on the Kemmel Straight. Lots of people now being released from the pit lane, getting back onto the circuit. And we're currently on lap 104 with the safety car out on track. And until the rain eases and the standing water can be addressed, everybody having to remain behind the safety car like this. Yesterday, there should have been an extra qualifying session for the top 20, the shootout of the Super Pole, to give the fans something to look at on the Friday for the GT cars, which did the bulk of their running on Thursday, and also for more media awareness of the Spa 24 Hours. And the heavens opened about 40 minutes or so before Super Pole should have started. There was a Formula 3 race that was cancelled, and the Superpole went the same way. The conditions were just deemed too bad, and therefore, with Superpole cancelled in conditions similar to this, everybody was expecting, therefore, that if the rain was heavy, it would have to be a safety car, or even worse, the race suspension. Well, thankfully, we've not seen a red flag in the history of the Spa 24 Hours, and the race director wants to keep it that way, keeping everybody running, albeit at this reduced pace. And the word is that given the weather and the fact that also now it's much darker and therefore even harder for the drivers in these conditions, the safety car's going to be out for some time yet. So that's where we're up to, sadly, as the rain continues to fall here. So the cars from Pouhon making their run now towards Pif Paf. 83 has just come in, the Porsche there with the door open. Philippe Gachet's car that he shares with Olivier Plat and Eric Clément, who is rapid in French GT races. Now, for the Pro Speed Porsche team, Maxime Soulet has been doing a good job. He's in the pits with Hayley.
Max, here we are in wonderful Spa. The weather is typical, isn't it? But so exciting for us to watch, really, once the safety car comes back in. How's it been for you so far here in the 24 hours?
We had a good start. I mean, the start of the race was very good. I started on P12 and then I came up to P4. And then we had a problem with the starter button. The cable came loose behind the dash, so we lost quite a bit of time, 7 laps, to find out what was the problem. But now we're getting back in the race and trying to catch up, so I hope it's going to work well.
It's wonderful to see the presence in the garage of the friends, family, fans here, joining the Belgium team, giving you lots of support.
A lot of support for Pro Speed. I mean, we've got, it's a famous team in Belgium, so I hope we won't disappoint him at the end of the race.
Thank you, Max.
Thanks. Maxime Soulet for Pro Speed in the Pro-Am class. Goes off to keep dry and out on track. Drivers continue at this reduced pace. Stefano Telli reported back earlier when the rain was at its heaviest that he could hear the rain sloshing around underneath the car, which was far from ideal. And we had Carl Aquaplaning past the pits and it was not good. Well, this time around, the drivers perhaps a little bit more aware of the conditions. In some cases, though, different drivers having to cope with the rain now than in that earlier downpour. In some cases, it's the same driver having either stayed in or got back in the car. And there are many drivers in this event who are regulars at Spa in myriad categories, be it Blancpain Endurance Series or sports prototypes or local GT events, like, for example, the new Belgian Racing Car Championship, who will have a bit more knowledge of what Spa is like when it's wet, where the grip might be, where the puddles might be, and they're trying to exploit that as best they can. So it is, for the moment, Audi leading the way, and the new for 2012 R8 LMS Ultra, which under the balance of performance is even heavier this event, another 40 kilos heavier it has become. And quite a few cars have been adjusted, including the BMW Z4 for 2012, the newer car, like the Mark VDS car, for example, that's 25 kilos heavier, and the front and rear ride height up by 10 millimetres as well. It's not an easy task trying to make all these different types of car comparable, because it's also very hard to factor into that the level of competence of teams and the speed of drivers. So it's not easy, it's not an exact science, and to try to prevent runaway winners, that's why you have the cars adjusted like this as the season goes on. So the BMW is heavier, higher, the Audi is heavier, the Ferrari 458 is heavier and higher by 8 millimetres, heavier by 25 kilos, and the McLaren's heavier by 25 kilos and 7 millimetres higher on the ride height. And the McLaren's were going pretty well in qualifying, particularly the Von Ryan Racing car 88 with Alvaro Parent at the wheel, and that was fastest in class. It's currently 11th in the classification, but has just pitted. In fact, Roger Wills, who is a prolific historic racer, he's got this amazing collection of cars, all of which he manages to race with great skill and speed, and leaps from one to the other regularly at the Masters Historic Festival at Brands Hatch, for example. He does every race, and he will hop from a Can-Am car to a front engine Grand Prix car to a rear engine Grand Prix car to a classic touring car, you name it, he's got one, he drives it well. And Roger Wills has done a bit more modern racing in recent times, and he has taken over that car now. And it's 11th as it came into the pit lane last time. Meantime, the Hardy Souls out in the outer paddock getting ready for the concert. They're getting underway shortly. The grandstand's starting to thin out a little bit as the stalwarts at the Spa 24 Hours look for alternative sources of entertainment or shelter. And that's the reason why, as everybody slithers their way through the piff-paff. Working tirelessly in the pit lane is Hayley Coxon. She's now found Belgian driver Enzo Ide.
Enzo, tell us how much you're enjoying this weather here and also obviously racing here in Spa.
Yeah, I just come out of the car. In the beginning of my stint, it was dry, drying up well. We had a dry track. And then 20 minutes before the end, start to thrash. Unbelievable. So it's already the third time. We had a safety car because of the rain. We'll see what brings next, but I had a lot of fun. So we hope we can go further to the top and see what brings. It's a long time to go. So.
Do you have anything to say to the Belgians watching at home in your native language?
Ja, we gaan ons best doen en proberen zoveel mogelijk naar van voor te rijden en op podium te belanden.
Thank you.
So, Enzo Ide, who was a very rapid driver within the GT3 European Championship last year, finished third in that for WRT, was also the winner of the Zolder 24 Hours last year, son of the very wealthy Belgian entrepreneur Joris Ide. Now this is a different way of enjoying the Spa 24 Hours. You're warm, you're dry, you've got alcohol in your hand, and everybody enjoying themselves in the Blancpain hospitality area. Smiles all round. And the other side of life at the Spa 24 Hours, this is. Some of the people there having already been racing this weekend within the Blancpain Lamborghini Super Trofeo. While the marshals don't have quite the same luxury. They've got an umbrella, they've got waterproofs, but they're going to be stuck out on their corners for quite some time to come. Yeah, in the paddock, various teams as well with hospitality structures to look after their guests, but also somewhere that the drivers can go and get something to eat when they're not behind the wheel of the car, not sitting in the garage, and maybe even get a bit of rest. And that is where the motorhomes are, opposite the pits. And looking across is the F1 pit lane, where teams are busy. Even though at the moment there are relatively few cars in the pit road, number one, the leading car, has just come in. So Christopher Husser has brought number one down the pit lane. And this potentially could now give number 16 Andrea Piccini the lead, depending on where Christopher Husser is in relation to him wanting to leave the pits and the queue of cars behind the safety car, whether he's going to be released or held. So we'll need to keep an eye on that. He's gone back into the race. In fact, he's just been let out. So Christopher Husser has rejoined, having been shown as being in the pit lane. He's back on track once again. And the number one Audi still looking very strong indeed in this. A car that's also going strongly, number 40, Greg Gilver, the car that he shares with Dino Lenardi and Philippe Albuquerque. That car started in the pit lane and has worked its way into contention now, running in eighth place. Greg Gilver, former Peugeot Spider racer, Megane Euro Cup racer, going well as down in the paddock, fans enjoying themselves. It's amazing what fruit and beer will do for you, despite the bad weather. And bad news from the paddock that comes from a driver himself is that the Pressispark Mercedes that Bernd Schneider started is out of the race. The car had an intermittent misfire from the start, says Mike Jordan. He got in for his stint and it wouldn't start. It was a wiring loom fault that Mercedes can't find. So although Bernd Schneider did a great job in qualifying and was well placed early on, I'm afraid to say that the car is out of the race. So disappointment for the British Mercedes team, but in the pit lane is Prince Albert, Montour and Taxis, and Hayley.
Albert, this year is certainly turning out to be much better than last year here for you.
Well, so far you can really say that, because we've progressed beyond one stint, so we've already made quite a bit of progress, and really overall it's running fantastically well so far. We've had a very, very good strategy. Hans really made the right call in the right moment to switch to slicks. We had an advantage of the drying circuit for a couple of laps, and switched back to rain tires in the decisive moment as well. So you can really say that we've made all the right decisions. We're on P5 overall. We are leading the class. Very exciting. Lots of pressure now for me. I'm about to jump into the car. So a bit scary, but a lot of fun.
Have you driven at night in Spa before?
I have driven at night for three laps yesterday. and for three laps last year. So that's really all I can, all the experience I bring. So it's a bit scary. Never driven in the wet for sure at night. So I guess a new experience.
Best of luck, Albert. Thank you.
Albert Maria Lamoral Miguel Johannes Gabriel, to give him his full name, a.k.a. Prince Albert von Turn und Taxis, the billionaire German, who has become a very rapid racing driver. He began in the Volkswagen Polo Cup, as you do if you're a prince, I suppose, and graduated from Polos to the Trofeo Maserati, and then into the European GT3 Championship, and then to GT1. And Albert von Turn und Taxis, a spectacular driver, and when he's behind the wheel of the Blancpain writer Lamborghini, and it's dry, he's going to be one to watch, that's for sure. Hopefully it will be dry before much longer, but for the moment the rain is set in, and so the teams continue to paddle round. The race director, you can understand why he wants people to be safe, and therefore the pace of the race much reduced, nobody being able to overtake under the safety car. You can of course gain places if people peel off and make their pit stops, that will shuffle the order, but for now everybody just has to remain in formation and continue around. The race is now 105 laps old. Race leader Christopher Hasser on that 106. At the moment, the advantage that he has over the number 16 car of Andrea Piccini is a slightly false one, given, of course, that there have been pit stops and that everybody has bunched up. And that's the bad news. Still safety car boards out, yellow lights flash, and people's attention at the circuit starts to turn to more important things like food. And from the impressive brasserie restaurant on top of the F1 pits, you can both eat and drink and, of course, keep tabs on the race. So, waiting for the second place car of Andrea Piccini to come through. And Christopher Hasser leading the way. Currently, it is Audi first, Audi second, BMW third, Audi fourth, Lamborghini fifth, because now number 24, you heard from Albert von Turn und Taxis, but Jos Menton has taken over the wheel of that car and is leading the Pro-Am class because of the slow, lengthy pit stop for Louis Machiels. Now, not just Mark VDS Racing here, but you've also got the VDS Racing Adventures team running a Ford Mustang and with a 1960s Ford Mustang on display as well, which looks absolutely great. And, of course, in the same colour scheme as the Handelsraten cars have run, both then and now, same degree as the current Ford Mustang has. The team manager of number 59 being summoned to the race director, that's the Vita 41 Team Italy Ferrari of Alessandro Bonetti, Andrea Ciccato, Michael Lyons, who had a spin early in the race, and Philip Salacquada, who started and drove very well, the ex-single-seater racer who drives for AF Corsa in the GT1 World Championship in the Ferrari. And 59 is currently to be found outside the top 20, I think I'm right in saying, in 30th place, Ciccato at the wheel of the car. But the race director wants a word, so possibly an infringement somewhere that needs assessing. So we've got, for the moment, the race-leading car of Christopher Hasser with Andrea Piccini behind. And three cars currently on the lead lap, Hasser, Piccini and Maxime Martin. Maxime yet to win the Spa 24 Hours. His dad, Jean-Michel, who's been racing this weekend, in fact, in the Lamborghini Blancpain Super Trofeo. He won it four times. Jean-Michel was in this race last year. He was part of the old boys team with Marc Duhaime and Eric Bachelard. But Jean-Michel just doing the two-driver Lamborghini races this weekend. But he has been out this year racing in historic Formula 1 cars with Masters on occasions as well. So still a great enthusiast, Jean-Michel Martin. Good racer, car dealer. And that's the view as the cars head down towards Caen as the race works its way. Now with still 18 hours to go into the darkness, and the consolation for the teams is that the weather should be better tomorrow and easier for them and get some proper racing in. But big frustration for everybody that the conditions are as they are. I know we've had heavy rain in the past at Spa, but I don't remember the necessity to have the safety car quite like this used quite as often. Yes, it's wet, yes, there is standing water, but the cars trying to disperse that as they continue to circulate. That's the team and media building in the paddock that Audi has, with just to the very right of the shot, the car that won Le Mans this year, the new hybrid TDI Quattro that took victory in the Le Mans 24 Hours, on display as well. Audi, as you can see from the gantry coming at pit in, a huge amount of effort to try to win the Spa 24 Hours. Won last year, did Audi, its first Spa 24 victory be associated with great success in sports car racing. It's true that it's mainly through prototype racing. So success here at the 1000Ks, lots of success at Sebring and at Le Mans, of course, but only one 24 hours of Spa victory. Gabriele Gardel has been doing good things for the Jaguar squad. He's with Hayley.
Gabrielle, we've seen you developing the car so far this season. You've entered competitively for the first time here in the 24 hours. What's going on with the Jaguar? Obviously, you're now out. What's the reasons for that?
Yes, unfortunately, after a big job done last week, we had a technical issue right now that we are still investigating on it. And unfortunately, we had to stop and make sense for us to go testing somewhere else. So we had to stop for a really small detail and but stop us, yeah.
Where is the actual issue on the car?
Yeah, it's electrical things that's connected to the engine, so it's honestly it's something that we cannot really fix it right now. This is a problem when we have to develop the car that's normal, and we're going to come back really competitive soon.
Thank you.
Great shame that, because it's good to have the Jaguar on the grid. Gabriele Gardel, who was a front runner in the FIA GT Championship in Ferrari days, quick driver, ex Formula 3 driver in Italy, Formula 3000, and has been racing in the ILMC and the Italian Carrera Cup recently as well. Quick driver, so great shame that we've lost that car. There it is, the car being developed by Emil Frey Racing, the grandfather of one of the drivers, in fact, Lorenz Frey, whose dad, Walter Frey, was a former touring car racer. And Emil Frey, big car leasing group in Switzerland, developing this GT3 Jaguar. But it's a tough project, and when there's only one of the cars, also it's hard to develop them because you're not getting as much data back as if you've got three or four. But of course, when you're taking on the might of Audi and Porsche, the team really having a tough, tough task. So too are the marshals, who are braving the elements, all volunteers. Quite a few British marshals here as well, in fact. The lure of the Spa 24 hours is always a good thing, but maybe they weren't expecting to get quite so drenched flocking here this weekend. But if you want to go motor racing and you can't afford to race but you want to get involved, then you can do a lot worse than be a marshal. Without them, racing couldn't happen, point blank. And it's not always this wet and arduous. There are days both in the UK and at Spa when the sun shines and it's a really good way of enjoying motor racing, and without them the sport just could not happen. So here, everywhere around the motor racing world, the marshals doing a stellar job, and a huge number of them here, of course, operating in shifts to make sure that some are on post, some get a break, and the marshalling force regulars at Spa for all events. And it's a place that doesn't just run a 24-hour race, they've got 12-hour races here, and even the 25-hour Fun Cup race. And they are out in their droves every weekend, every event at Spa. You're looking at the Pro Cup standings at the moment as the marshals inquire as to what the weather forecast may have in store. And the SC boards are still being held, the yellow lights are on around the circuit, the yellow flags are being shown as well. And the race currently on lap 107 with, after the most recent round of pit stops, Andrea Piccini into the lead of the race. The fire crews in the pit lane as well, just in case we have another conflagration like we had from the earlier Porsche of Eric Demmer when he came into the pit lane well ablaze. And in the spectator areas, it's pretty wet. So you can see the amount of water still running downhill. And, of course, the nature of Spa, with all these hills, means that when the rain does come in such volume, it's always going to have to gather somewhere. And drainage is good, but there's still standing water around in the paddocks and the spectator areas and on track. Although, maybe I'm kidding myself a bit here, it does look a bit brighter than it did. It does look a bit better. The rain is not bouncing off the road in front of me like it was a few minutes ago. So maybe we are getting towards a stage now where the race director might release them. We'll start to think about releasing them at least. As I said earlier on, Eduardo Freitas in the earlier safety car period built up to the release of the cars by getting the safety car to go faster, giving the drivers a chance to experience what the track was like at a quicker speed, and then an even quicker speed and quicker again, rather than just releasing them from very slow laps straight into racing. Giving them a chance to assess what the track conditions are like, gradually building up to it. And you may well do that again, but as yet we're not getting any information as to that being imminent. Back in the pit lane though, Nick Homerson's car lost its class lead after a long pit stop. Let's find out exactly why. Nick is with Hayley.
Nick, you were leading your class earlier, you did lose time in the pits. What was the reason for that?
I think we have a problem with one of the gear levers, and I hope they fix it now, so we'll see what happens after tonight.
Was it up or down on the gear lever?
It was the downshifting. So, yeah, we were running pretty good, had a good pit stop. But just some small little thing.
And what are your views on Spa in the wet?
Well, it's part of it, you know. This is for me the fourth time, and I've never had a dry one. So this is what's supposed to be.
And how do you like driving in the nighttime here?
Oh, it's great. It's great. You know, I haven't been in so far, but they did this to me last year as well. So sometimes they just throw you in at the deep end, I guess.
Best of luck. Thank you.
Nick Homerson, who has raced in the Ferrari Challenge and then in Lamborghinis before he was the Pro-Am class champion last year within the Blancpain Endurance Series. He began, and not many people own up to doing this, in the Donkervoort Cup, the quirky Dutch-built cars that raced briefly in the Supersport class of GT4, but there was, for reasons unknown, a one-mate championship for Donkervoort, and Nick Homerson won that. And he, Louis Machiels, Andrea Bertolini and Alessandro Pierguidi were the drivers of the 52 Ferrari. And as you've just heard, it's lost its class lead because of this downshift problem. That means that Jos Menten in the Blancpain Lamborghini leads the class from Nico Verdonk in the McLaren. Louis Machiels is at the wheel of that Ferrari now, third in class. Louis Machiels, you might remember, drew attention to himself in last year's Spa 24 Hours for constantly ignoring a black flag. He'd been given a stop-go penalty. It was on the timing screens. The team told him, but the radio either wasn't working or wasn't plugged in properly. And so for lap after lap, Louis Machiels continued. For lap after lap, the team tried to get his attention. And it didn't get the attention of the driver. And in the end, the race director lost patience and gave a black flag. And the car was brought into the pit lane and was not allowed to rejoin. The team kept its points that it had scored at 6 and 12 hours, but it wasn't allowed to rejoin. And that was a big, big disappointment. It was Homerson, Machiels, Bertolini and Michael Bartel sharing the car when it was a Vita 4-1 Ferrari last year. This year, Homerson, Machiels, Bertolini and Alessandro Pierguidi all teaming up for AF Corsa. But at the time, we talked to Andrea Bertolini and he said, well, I hope we don't get disqualified from the race because, you know, we're doing everything we can to get the driver into the pit lane. But because the black flag had been ignored and the penalty not taken, the car had to be withdrawn. And therefore, Louis Machiels, for all the wrong reasons, got lots of attention. But the way that the team tried to get his attention, almost falling over the pit wall, was quite impressive at times. It's not just waving flags and being attentive to driver safety that the marshals need to do at Spa, it's also a bit of drainage work and getting ever more with drainage. That rain that you're looking at out on the circuit, dare I say, is getting heavier once again. So the optimism we had a little while ago looked like it might well now be misplaced. Coming over the timing line just in front of me behind the safety car, and really frustrating situation this for everybody involved, that the race hasn't really got yet into a rhythm. Now, one driver who's also frustrated because he's going no further is Lucas Ordóñez. Hayley, all yours.
Lucas, it's wonderful to have you back. How have you been having fun back here at Spa?
Well, it's fantastic to be back to GT racing here in Blancpain Series. First time to drive a GT3 car, Nissan GT-R GT3. It's been a good weekend for us. We found a good pace for the car, and you know, not in qualifying, but for the race, we knew that the car was quite fast, and also in wet conditions, the car was fantastic. But you know, this racing now we had some problems after 2 hours of race, and now. You know, the car is stuck in Orus corner, so we decide to retire, and it's really tough to don't go through the night with this fantastic car. But it's that's motorsport, no? This is my second time in a Spa 24 hours. My second did not finish, but keep pushing, no? I can't ask for a lot more. It's my fourth 24 hours this year, so. Looking forward for the next one.
And you're racing here once again with Jan Mardenborough, the new winner, the 2011 winner. And he's been doing so fantastically well. And yourself, you've been flying since 2008. It's such a great achievement, isn't it, for the team and for Nissan?
Yeah, of course. We're proving that GT Academy program is working well. I'm in Le Mans 24 hours, finishing second last year. Now Jan Mardenborough stepping up to GT3 in his first year in racing, and having a really, really good performance. No, he's showing the pace. He's been really, really fast through the first hour in the race. But yeah, keep pushing and keep showing everyone that Nissan is strong, and we'll be back stronger for sure.
Lucas, thank you.
Thank you.
Lucas Ordóñez, who raced at Le Mans this year with Martin and Alex Brundle, and the winner of the very first PlayStation Academy competition, the ultimate couch-to-cockpit competition. Jan Mardenborough, the winner of it last year. Jordan Tresson, who was the middle winner, was part of the GT4 championship-winning team of last year in the Blancpain Endurance Series. Chris Ward, Alex Buncombe joining Jan Mardenborough and Lucas in the car for this weekend. But a short-lived race, really disappointing that the team, having had a British GT win in the Nissan at Brands Hatch in June, when Alex and Jan Mardenborough shared the car to victory by 22 thousandths of a second. That was the winning margin at the end of 2 hours of racing. Stunning end battle it was between Jan Mardenborough, who drove in a way that really belied his lack of experience, because he hadn't at that point been racing for a full season. And the way that he handled the car and the pressure from Johnny Adam, who was chasing him, was mighty impressive indeed, and he hung on to score that win. But here, very early, very big disappointment to lose that car, because it became so strongly early on in the race. So as the safety car continues to circulate, the drivers now starting to think about when the next round of pit stops may be. But of course, there's not a huge amount of wear, and fuel is no longer a problem, fuel consumption. Even if it was, it's reduced anyway because of the safety car, but fuel consumption in the race anyway is less of an issue because of the fact that you can't do more than 65 minutes in a stint. And you can do 70 if the safety car is out at the end of your stint. Because, for example, if you try and time it very very tight to the end of that 65 minutes, the safety car is deployed all of a sudden and you lose a slow in-lap, which takes you the wrong side of 65 minutes and you get penalised unfairly. So you're given this 5 minute bit of grace at the end of your stint if the safety car is on track. But therefore, in this race, it's not a case of making the fuel last, because you can only go 65 minutes before a pit stop anyway. It's less of a problem for the teams. It was brought in because of the size of the fuel tank of some of the cars, and it was deemed that it was fairer to have that 65 minute rule, so it level things out. Some teams straight away complain and say, well, it takes away our advantage because we're fuel efficient, but you can't please everybody. So here at Spa, it's getting darker and darker and darker, and still it is a very wet circuit indeed. The first year of the championship coming here, the Blancpain Endurance Series, was in its inaugural year last season. The 2010 race, if you like, was the race that was the catalyst for the Blancpain Endurance Series. It was a mixture of GT2, GT3 and GT4 cars, and the first GT year was 2001, the year that Christophe Bouchou, Jean-Philippe Belloc and Marc Duet were the winners in that Chrysler Viper, because the previous seasons had been rather disappointing. Gradually, as a touring car event, the Spa 24 Hours had been losing its cachet, really, because the European Touring Car Championship was no more, and it was being run as a glorified Belgian Touring Car Championship round, and occasionally manufacturers like Nissan, like BMW, for example, would come along and put cars in it and star drivers. But when touring car racing was going purely super touring, it ran for a couple of years as a Group N race. In fact, that was when you had Peugeot 306s winning it. Fred Bouvier, Emmanuel Collard, Anthony Beltoise in 1999, Bouvier, Kurt Mollekens, Didier Dufourny the year after. And it was at that point, with small grids and 2 litre touring cars in Group N production saloon car trim, that the organisers said, this isn't really what we want anymore. We need something to make the event a big event again. And with GT racing in the FIA GT era getting big grids, the Spa 24 Hours hooked up with SRO, became part of the FIA GT Championship, and SRO has looked after the event ever since. And with the GT1 World Championship becoming sprint races, so the 24 Hours had to become something different. That's why it became a GT2, GT3, GT4 race, and because of the success of that, with so many different brands on the grid, that was the catalyst for the 3R races that are within the Blancpain Endurance Series, which next year will be 5 events, not 6, according to the announcement that we had yesterday here. But there is the possibility that we may have one of those being a 1,000-kilometre race for next year. Back to the pit lane. Hayley has now found Matteo Bobby.
Matteo, we've certainly seen you successfully walk into the team manager's position for the team here this year. How have you found Spa so far for you guys?
I mean, so far in the 57 car, it's looking quite good. We are P6 at the moment, so we... In a few minutes, we close the 6 hour. For us, it was important to score as maximum point as we can, that we are leading the championship. So the first goal is more or less achieved. On the other car, we had not a good luck when we had a small touch and we lost 3 laps, but still 18 hours to go. So we try to recover and go back.
And have you found your new managerial role?
It's something different. I'm still driver, but I miss driving in this race so much, but it's something different, but it's always nice.
Thank you, Matteo.
There is good news. The safety car is in at the end of this lap, so we've had pretty much an hour of safety car, and without the cars this time having increased their speed, the lights are out. The safety car is going to be in this time. The message is there on the screen, and so we can go back to racing. And the leading car is the number 16 Audi. Andrea Piccini is at the wheel of it, ahead of number one Audi of Christopher Hasse, being operated by different teams. Phoenix ahead of WRT. And the safety car peels into the pit lane now. The green flags will be shown. The green lights come on around the circuit as well. And we're back racing in the Total 24 Hours of Spa as the cars storm their way across the timing line. And straight away, as you can see from the way the headlights fan out across the road, three wide, go cars down towards La Source, which is pretty brave, seeing that there's still a lot of standing water around and it's getting darker and darker. It's all part of the challenge of this race. Out of La Source, downhill, heading towards Eau Rouge. And of course, the way that the safety cars are scrambled, they don't always pick up the leader. Then you get pit stops anyway, which disturbs the sequence of cars behind the safety car. So Andrea Piccini is the one to try to find in the number 16 Audi, leading the way with Christopher Hasse going after him in number one. Maxime Martin driving the number three BMW third. Now, just to pick up on that car for a moment, Maxime Martin has driven it so far, Bas Lyners has driven it so far, but not yet Marcus Pautela. Why? It's not because he's slow. Marcus Pautela has a stop-go penalty as a legacy of the infringement he had on Thursday in free practice when he improved his time under a sector, and the consequence of that was he was given this stop-go penalty. Now, the team doesn't want to lose too much time before they get points at 6 hours, and therefore they're not going to put him in the car until the end of 6 hours for fear of a long pit stop and therefore losing time and losing points, which they're going to need within the championship. So the number three BMW, therefore, for the moment, is just being between Maxime Martin and Bas Lyners, and the drivers between them doing the lion's share of the work. Now, we've heard the disappointing news from Lucas Ordóñez with Haley down in the pit lane that the Nissan number 35 is no longer in the race, and therefore we don't get a chance, as we see 66 BMW coming into the pit lane for a stop, we don't get a chance to see Jan Malvenbrück out behind the wheel of the car, but I'm delighted to say that Jan has joined me up here. I know you'd like to be out there, but maybe not in these conditions yet.
Oh, well, yeah, I'd love to be out there in these conditions. I was out there, at the second stint, and from Alex, car was going fantastic. Felt really good balance in the car. We qualified 41st, Alex got up to 35th, and I got up to 20th at the end of my stint, and handed over to Chris. It's had an electrical fault with the car, and spent a long time in the pit lane, and Chris got out, got the guys fixed it, Adrian Motorsport guys fixed it, and we stopped again at the end of the pit lane at turn four, and the guys couldn't get restarted again, so disappointing really. I'd love to be out there at the moment.
We've just seen the number 8 Porsche having a big spin, having dropped its way down the order anyway, but when you were out, you had the standing water to worry about. Now the guys have got standing water and there's no light, you know, it's getting darker and darker, so there's like a double challenge for you.
Yeah, definitely. It's very difficult to see standing water anyway, and it's even more difficult in the dark when the headlights, they're bright, but for sure they don't pick up the standing water, so it's very difficult and tricky to keep it on the black stuff out there at the moment, so props to the guys currently out there.
Now, we were talking a little while ago about that amazing race you had at Brands Hatch, which was a joy to watch, and considering that you haven't done a full season of racing, you're driving like you've been driving GT cars for decades. That was a heck of a drive.
Yeah, the car felt really good there. The setup was really nice. The qualifying, we were 4/10 off pole, 1/10 would have got us to 5th, and in the race the car was amazing. It was the best it's ever felt, and the Arjun Motorsport guys set up the car really well. We've had no testing of the car, so it would be very difficult to use practice sessions to try new stuff out, and sometimes it's worked, sometimes it hasn't, and it all came together at Brands Hatch there, and I was massively pleased, and the team were hugely pleased as well. So,
22 thousandths of a second as a winning margin after 2 hours. I mean, You come onto the pit straight, checkered flag ahead of you, Johnny Adam in the Aston behind you. What goes through your mind? Are you thinking, oh no, he's going to get me, or did you think you could just hang on here?
Well, for the last but one corner, the left-hander, he had a really good exit, and I just knew I'm going to have to defend into the last corner here. I defended really hard, and otherwise would have dived down the inside and got me. So it's a bad exit, obviously, from the last corner. And I went out wide, I went to the inside, and he went to the outside, and we sort of crossed the finish line bang on. And I was instantly onto the radio with the guys and saying, did we win it? And they didn't reply, and I pressed the radio again, and I just heard cheers, and I just knew we'd won it. So it was a fantastic moment.
I say you haven't been racing at that point for a full season. For people that don't know, you won the PlayStation Academy, but what does that mean? What did you have to go through to become a racing driver?
Well, basically, last year, around January time, there's a competition held every year now. The first winner is Lucas Ordonez, and it's GT Academies, and it's about taking people who are fast in a gaming world on a PlayStation, on a GT5 game, and see if they're quick in a racing car. And there's various stages of the competition that you progress through just to qualify, then you're for national finals and to the international events at Silverstone, where you're racing real life cars, Nissan GTR, 370Zs with instructors, and basically you're judged on everything. And I was the victor of 90,000 people that year, and chucked into a racing car come July to get our international C license to race in the Dubai 24 Hour Race in January this year. So, and come third in class, and that was a gamer car. All four winners were racing in that race, and come third in class in Dubai. And we're just trying to carry the baton, because Lucas Ordonez, he's set a really high standard. Second at Le Mans, his first time there, and we're just trying to continue the success of the program.
I heard you on the radio talking a little while ago about the fact that, as some people say, oh, you know, sitting in front of a computer game is bad for you. You are, so is Lucas, proof that actually, by being very good on things like a computer or a PlayStation, you can actually make a career by doing that, which is something that people don't really anticipate.
No, it's, a lot. My parents didn't really have the idea that if I played on the PlayStation game a lot, it would get me a job. So I sort of proved them wrong, and hopefully we can prove other people wrong as well. Definitely something in the game's physics and the basic hand-eye coordination and various things with throttle input and steering input that were very realistic. And when I got into a racing car, it felt normal. There was differences where obviously G-forces and fatigue, various things like that. But overall, it hasn't done me much harm anyway. It's
not a bad job to have, is it, man?
It's fantastic. It's the best job in the world. I absolutely love it.
Well, it's a great shame you're not on the track, Jan, but good to see you. Pass the microphone, if you will, over to Lucas Ordonez, who's joined us in here as well. We've heard from Lucas trying to keep dry in the pit lane. Now, of course, you're further ahead, if you like, of Jan, Lucas, because you've done a few more years of racing, so you've now not just done GT cars, but sports prototypes as well. What about this? Got the rain, got the darkness, you've got a huge field, 66 cars started. It's a real challenge for the drivers, this.
Yeah, it's going to be a really, really tough night for the drivers, for the teams. Changing conditions all the time, and now heavy rain, standing water. Spa is a very dark track, so, and you know, up and down, so the water and the rivers are moving around, so it's really tricky to drive in these conditions.
And that's what a driver sees, yeah. Which is nothing. You see nothing.
Yeah, you can see pretty much. No, you just see about 50 meters in front, and you know, fog, and it's really, really tricky conditions. You have to think about it's a 24 hours race, try to be on the black stuff as much as you can, and don't get any risk, no?
Sure.
Put the traction control in the maximum to try to be safe and conservative, and that's the way to win a 24 hours like Spa.
Are there certain parts of the circuit that are brighter than others? There's a bit more illumination, so it's not the same darkness all the way around, which is maybe better, maybe worse in some ways.
Yeah, well, you know, at some points it's really, really dark, and somewhere like here in the main straight is quite light, you know. You have to manage to get used to it, to your eyes, and to take as much reference as you can to in the braking points and to find where is the standing water, no? Concentration and focus is the most important thing at these conditions, and that's what the drivers have to do.
So what do you do now? Sadly, your car's out of the race. Do you stay and watch, or do you go to the party and the concert?
Well, I don't think I'm going to do any of both, but you know, it's disappointing for us, but we know we have a really, really potential car. The Nissan GTR proved that has a really, really good pace. Jan showed it, and Alex in the first stint. But, you know, now, you know, disappointing moment, but it's time to, you know, to be strong, to think in the future. We know that the car has a lot of potential, so we need to, you know, get back to the hotel, have a rest, and you know, get back tomorrow here to pack and to see what happens at the end of the race.
Is there a PlayStation in the truck? You can go and use that as the compromise.
Yeah,
there is. Yeah.
We have one in the motorhome for training. So
Naturally, of course.
We are PlayStation winners here, so of course we have to do some training on the simulator.
It was a great shame the car's not in the race, guys. Thanks for coming up and. Commiserations once again, and fingers crossed that things will go better for Jan next week in British GT at Snetterton, and then in future Blancpain Endurance Series races. Lucas Adonia, Jan Mardner, thanks both
very much
indeed. So sadly, we lose the RJM Motorsport Nissan, but no doubt the car will bounce back, as I say, in a week's time at Snetterton British GT, and two more races within the Blancpain Endurance Series to look forward to as well. So while we've been talking to drivers, we've had a bit of shuffling because of pit stops within the overall order. And there, number three BMW is now back up front, Maxime Martin at the wheel. But he's also made a pit stop. And so when he comes back onto the circuit, the newly won lead will have disappeared again. So depending on when a car pits, the lead baton is handed at the moment between number three BMW, number one Audi and number 16 Audi. Maxime Martin in the BM, Christopher Hasser in Audi number one, Andrea Puccini in number 16. And at some point, get the calculators out and work out when people are making pit stops, and then extrapolate that towards the end of 24 hours, because it would appear that whoever is going to make the last pit stop is going to lose the lead, so you do not want to be that car. So it'll take a bit of calculation this when we get a chance, try and work it out, and then you factor in more safety cars and different pace of drivers, because of course we still haven't yet seen Marcus Tautola in number three for the reasons we've been explaining. Now, you get points at 6 hours. We're not that far away from having to do some calculations on that front as well, are we? Race only started at 4 p.m. Maxime Martin leading the way now, but it's where cars are at the lap they cross the line after that 6 hour mark. That's when the points are going to be given, so we'll get the bulletin from the official timekeepers very shortly, and that in turn we'll start to work out where points are going to be allocated, if you like, a race within a race, the 6 hour race. And it's points in class, not for overall position, but it's where you are in your class at the end of 6 hours, points again at the end of 12, but nothing at the end of 18 hours. You've got to then go to the end of the race itself in order to get another haul of points. Now, we had a spin a little while ago from the number 8 Porsche of Mike Sturzberg. He can explain himself now. He's in the pits with Hayley.
Mike, I understand you think you made a bad tyre strategy choice. Tell us all about it.
Yeah, we gambled. So the track was definitely dry, and we changed. But after three or four laps, it starts to rain. And at the moment when it starts to rain, it's terrible. Every time safety car, and my stint, I was over 55 seconds of the safety car and two laps in a normal pace. But it is a nightmare.
Tell us, besides that, tell us how much of a challenge it is for you racing here, obviously in the wet, but in the dark as well at Spa.
Yeah, it's you can compare it with a Nordschleife, but in the night with the rain, it is really a disaster. You can't see anything. It's unbelievable. But it's almost fun. Yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
Off the road is the 59 Ferrari. That's the Beta 41 Team Italy car trying to rejoin. But has it hit the barrier? Has it done much damage? Can it rejoin from there? It's not that long ago, in fact, that we had the race director wanting to see the team manager of that car. And it is Andrea Ciccato that's put it off the road. There in the pit lane is the 82 Viper, about to rejoin. Gilles Vanelet brought the car in. This is the car that caught fire at Paul Ricard and has been patched up. They're back into the race. Andrea Ciccato in the 59 Ferrari. Place is lost as a consequence of that, but it's back on track, which is the good news. Still, it's hellishly wet out there. Drivers still having to cope, as we've been making the point, with the lack of light, with the lack of grip as well. 59 having bounced off the tyre wall, back onto the circuit again. And again, the drivers, the team's being warned about that on the timing screen, so they're aware that there's a car off around the circuit. So as the lead baton continues to be traded It's now number one, Christopher Hauser back up front. Maxime Martin has fallen back into third place. And the pit lane has just come to sixth place down in number 40, Greg Gilvert, in the Santelot Racing car. It's a French team that began in Renault Clio Racing, gradually built itself up, and has now become a bit more of a force to be reckoned with in GT racing as well. Now, as far as this lead situation is concerned, Christopher Hauser leading the way was caught last time around by Andrea Puccini. The gap was down by the best part of 3 seconds, so it's a genuine battle for the race lead. And it's number one that leads the way, chased by the number 16 Audi. I'll tell you which ball of spray they are in a moment when they next come into shot, but trying to pick the dark coloured number one Audi up in the gloom in the spray, not the easiest of jobs for cameraman. But there is 16, that's the chasing Audi. Andrea Puccini at the wheel of it, and in the first sector of this lap he was slightly slower, so the gap is wide and just a touch. But of course, in these conditions, the closer you get to the car ahead, the less you see anyway because of the spray. So it's Christopher Hauser at the wheel, Christopher Mies, Stefan Ortelli, the other two drivers, and watching on as in the middle sector of the lap again, in fact, Christopher Hauser is just slightly quicker. The 7 Ferrari powers through the Paul Frère corner up towards Blanchimont, heading towards the end in the leader's case of lap 114 here. After the bus stop, up over the timing line come the cars now, and the bus stop has been a place where one or two have come to grief earlier on in the race. Haven't had perhaps quite the same drama for the race leaders we had last year. If you think back to the early stages, we had the Pro Speed Porsches driving into one another, we had Lamborghinis rolling into the pit lane, Lamborghinis having big engine failures, and Audi's also working their way from lowly good positions up into the mix. Well, it's been very different this year with the weather and with the elongated safety car periods. The leaders have gone by with the gap being 1.6 seconds between the two Audis, and so Christopher Hauser leading the way, but only just. Andrea Puccini coming back at him as they came across the timing line, then the gap down once more, even though it seemed as though Hauser was the stronger across the sectors of that lap, but he's not getting away from Puccini. 57 Ferrari about to be lapped, so you've got the leading car as the second set of headlights of the first two there, going through the shot, and that set of headlights, the third set, is the car that's second in the race. Andrea Puccini hunting down the race leader, heading up now through Radiant, along the Camel Straight, up towards Les Combes. And this is where Christopher Hauser needs to try to go offline and do some overtaking, put that back marker behind him. And has he gone through on the inside? Not yet, he hasn't. There is the leading car, number one, Christopher Hauser, still stuck behind the 57 Ferrari it is, which is the Eugenio Amos, Giacomo Petrobelli, Alessandro Bonaccini and Jonathan Hirschi car. And it's Jonathan Hirschi, in fact, at the wheel of it, the Swiss driver, who has been racing for the last couple of years in the GT1 World Championship, former Swiss Formula Renault racer. But he's ahead of the leader, and so as long as the leader is stuck there, then he is going to be losing time. He's being caught by number 16, and as if that wasn't bad enough, of course, the number 16 Audi has had less time in the pits, made one less pit stop as well, so it's looking good in that respect. Also, all the years of experience that Audi has built up over the sports car programme being used to good effect here. Team WRT running the numbers 1 and 2 car, but Phoenix Racing looking after number 16, that's Moses' team, and the car currently then running in second spot, and with the number 6 Fessler Lotterer Christensen car badly delayed earlier on, that effectively now out of the equation, the hopes, if you like, of the unofficial worked cars resting on number 16. Tom Christensen is up into 47th. I think the car was 64th at one stage, but it has powered its way back. I'm not saying it's into contention yet, but it's certainly up the order again, and that car continuing to gain places over the course of the race. So you're on board the Audi, and this is what it's like from on board around Spa. Got a battle then on track between the two Audis, but we've also now had confirmation of the classification at the six-hour mark and therefore when points were awarded. And the way that Mark VDS Racing has worked its pit stops, it was absolutely spot on, because as others were coming in and out of the pit lane, number three BMW was the car that inherited the lead and hung on to it at the six-hour mark. So the points at 6 hours go the way of Bas Linders, Maxime Martin and Marcus Paltel, even though he's not yet driven the car. So they've done everything absolutely right there. They've kept him out of the car. They've not lost any time through the penalty. And number three then, the Mark VDS Racing BMW, led at the end of 6 hours and therefore gets, as far as the championship is concerned at that point, 12 points. 9 points go the way of Christopher Hasser, Christopher Mies and Stefan Ortelli. And classified third at 6 hours was the Piccini Rast Stippler Audi. Fourth at the six-hour mark, Bonanomi Soundstrom and Vantour. Fifth overall, leading its class, the Lamborghini of Hayek Cox, Benton and other Bonton taxis. And in sixth spot was the number 36 BMW, Stefan Lemre, Jeffrey Van Hooydonk and Jeroen Den Boer car. That is in a different class. So the class positions, give me the bulk of them from the Pro Cup, Pro-Am, maximum points at 6 hours go the way of the Blancpain Ryder Lamborghini from the Verdonk, Mondrian, Clark, Vanderpool, McLaren, and the AF Corsa Ferrari, the Andrea Bertolini, Nikonosson car we have from Nikonosson. That was third in class at the time. The Gentleman Trophy being headed by number 25, the first motorsport Porsche of Bert Renner, Armand Flumel, Johan van Loo, and Steve Van Bellingham. And the Cup class being headed by the Pro GT Porsche. And that's the colour Alan Fairtay put on class pole position. So the concerts have started, the fireworks are going off, and the race at the moment is continuing in wet, slippery, torrid conditions, but the party has begun. And so we've got the atmosphere improving as the fans now start to make their way to the concert. They enjoy the fireworks, and there's another distraction for the drivers, as if the rain and everything else was enough. They've now got fireworks to think about as well, as that's something they catch out of the corner of their eye. Also, news from United Autosports. Mark Blundell not feeling terribly well at the moment, so as he's not able to get back into the car, they're just having to shuffle the strategy a little bit to accommodate that. Now then, Pierre Dieudonné, a race winner at the Spa 24 Hours, now team manager, is with Hayley.
Yeah, we can see that number one and number 16 are competing each other. 16 is one stop behind number one. Will there be any team orders given or will they be successfully competing against each other for that top spot?
No, they are free to make race. You know, it's a race, and on top of that, it's a different team. So there is a little bit of competition, but of course, all the drivers have been instructed to be extremely careful between Audi teams. And they are big boys, they are professionals, and we rely on them to behave on the track.
You've obviously raced lots of times here before, Pierre. Have you ever seen conditions like this?
Yes, it happens, and I think it's a long time ago, but I have known things like that. It's typical Spa. Of course, it doesn't happen every year, but yes, it's horrendous, and this year it is especially bad, yeah.
Thank you.
Pierre Dieudonné, I should know, written about the race, having raced and won the Spa 24 Hours, and he's done that both as a team manager and as a driver himself, winner in Mazda RX-7s and then overseeing other teams' victories here as well. And Pierre Dieudonné, very, very quick touring car racer himself in the 1980s. It was a regular feature of races in the European Touring Car Championship and for a number of years in the Group A era, the Bathurst 1000 as well. He was part of the Eichenberger Texaco Frontiera squad. The 1987 World Touring Car Championship year, and then in the ETC the year after, after the collapse of the World Championship. But these days, let's see Pierre racing. We see him running teams, and he and Vincent Voss doing a great job at Team WRT. Successful in the GT1 World Championship and in the Blancpain Endurance Series, and a team that would really love a race win here at the 24 Hours of Spa. And it's a very spectacular sight now, despite the fact that we've got this heavy rain. With the sky so dark, the fireworks standing out even more. Great shot of the cars out through Les Combes there, underneath the fireworks. And all part of the atmosphere of the Spa 24 Hours. The race, of course, an entity in itself, but it is part of the Blancpain Endurance Series, part of this championship, and points awarded as we've just had them at the six-hour mark. So now the championship situation changing again. and Maxime Martin last time through was over 10 seconds quicker than the Audi drivers that he's chasing. Christopher Hasse and Andrea Pacini are doing 2.59s, and or 2.58 in the case of Hasse, 2.59 in Pacini's case, and Maxime Martin has just done a 2.47. So he's certainly throwing caution to the wind. He's taking far more risks, and he's hunting down the Audis. Now, whether the Audis have got anything in reserve, they can up their pace if they need to. It's possible, as they can see Tom Christensen's car into the pits and a driver change going on. Lotterer started, it went Fassler and then Christensen, so perhaps back to Lotterer now. And the way that Maxime Martin is going, won't be long, I think, before he is up with the leading Audis once again, but absolutely storming. Pierre Giudano said to me at Silverstone that the reason that the Audis dropped away in the last hour of that race was because it was Maxime Martin driving the BMW. He's just very, very fast. Frank Kettler on the Thursday evening press conference said that Maxime Martin is the best GT3 driver around, and that's pretty high praise coming from a guy who's just taken pole position. And Maxime Martin is underlining why he is considered to be so good. He is now up into second place. He's just worked his way past Pacini on that lap, and so now he's going after the race leader. So Christopher Hasse leads, and the gap is 0.4 of a second between them. So the number three BMW, which is in the first sector of the lap, will be up into the lead of the race on this lap, barring a disaster, I would have thought. Christopher Hasse may try and make life hard, but of course he's got to identify which set of headlights he needs to block, doesn't he? Not that easy now, because in these conditions and in the darkness. But Maxime Martin is getting closer and closer and closer all the while to the leading number one Audi. Traffic for the drivers remains a constant problem, and it has been a problem really since the start of the race. It's something everybody has to deal with, everybody has to accept it, but now with the rain and with detritus around the edge of the circuit, as well as the rubble has been chunking and spat to one side, then going offline to get past slower cars becomes ever more of a hazard, especially when some of the less experienced gentlemen racers are behind the wheel, which may be a situation where they are perhaps unpredictable. Andre Lotterer is back at the wheel of number six, the car 47th. Where will it get to come the end of 24 hours? I'm sure it's going to finish the race, but it lost the best part of 30 minutes while the suspension was repaired after that big whack from the Adam Christodoulou McLaren. Adam, you saw in the highlights, trying to go to the pit lane, cutting across the front and damaging both cars, spitting his McLaren into the barrier. He has been excluded from the race, on which opinion is divided. It's the stewards that look after the penalties and such like. They have excluded Adam from driving again. Quite a few people think it was a bit harsh, but the stewards have decided that it was serious enough an offence for him to be excluded for entering the pit lane in a dangerous manner, causing a collision. So twofold really, one with the accident, but the other was the way he came into the pits or tried to come into the pit lane. And so Adam Christodoulou, rightly or wrongly, is no more in the race. The car can continue, albeit badly delayed after that drama and a spin. Phil Quaife was behind the wheel of the car when it spun going to La Source, and the number 62 McLaren, after those problems, is now 57th, in fact, the Dutch driver Klaus Hummel behind the wheel of that car, and just made a pit stop as well. And Christopher Hasse, he's no longer the leader because Maxime Martin has just gone across the line, and the Mark VDS Racing BMW is back up front. So in two laps, he's got himself past two cars. He's put himself into the lead of the race. And so now Maxime Martin, whose last lap was a 2.45 against Christopher Hasse's 2.51, is in the lead of the race, and he will now start to break away. I'm pretty sure of that as he plunges downhill once again. So Maxime Martin turns his way from Rouge uphill. And given these lap times, he will go storming away from the opposition now. The only other driver who has been doing lap times comparable to Maxime Martin has been Tom Christensen. And it's a shame now that Tom has had to give the car back to Andre Lotterer, but Andre might be worth watching now. Mark Blundell, I'm told, has had to go and see the Audi doctor. I was mentioning a few minutes ago that he's not feeling very well and really struggling for whatever reason. So the Audi doctor has had a look at the X-Grand Prix racer, and with Mark no longer, for the moment at least, for the foreseeable future, able to get behind the wheel of the car, United Autosports having to change the strategy and therefore work out how best to use Alain Lee, Richard Mines, Mark Patterson, who are the other drivers of that car. Mark Blundell started, but say feeling not well at all, the 1992 Le Mans 24-hour winner, having to sit out the remainder of the race potentially. Now there, on track, battles in the classes, and got the Mercedes Porsche fight developing nicely. Maxime Martin's charge off that latest safety car period certainly paying dividends. He's leading the way, pulling clear, and the speed that he's doing through the speed traps is astonishingly good compared to that of the rather more circumspect Christopher Hasse, because he, in the speed trap going up towards Le Combe, a fair chunk slower. Andrea Puccini is also falling away from Hasse in second place. The view at Le Combe. Lower down the order, Frank Kettler, pole man, back at the wheel of number 66, the Vita 41 BMW. Now he's a lap down on the race leaders, but after the recent safety car period, we've got four cars in the lead lap because back into the mix has come number two, Marco Bonanomi at the wheel. So the character of the race is shuffling around, still changing. And in fifth place, you've got Nico Verdonk in the number five McLaren. Don't rule him out because we've seen that he's a quick driver as well in both GT cars and prototypes. And number 10 you've just been looking at, which is currently being driven by Olivier Panis, is into the top 20 once again. Olivier Panis, of course, Monaco Grand Prix winner and BAR and Toyota Formula 1 racer after his time at Ligier and Prost, the man that's been racing in French GT most recently with Eric Debar, who is another driver of this car, and a spell driving in prototypes for Oracle, but then said, OK, I think they've got a bit too fast for me. I'm happy racing GT cars. He's stepped back from prototype racing, but Olivier Panis going strongly at the moment and lapping a fair chunk quicker than the next four cars ahead of him. So Panis should be on for more places to be gained before long, I think. There is 57 into the pit lane, driver change, and Jonathan Hershey getting out of the car. Also in has come number 16, Andrea Puccini back to Frank Stippler. Goes in, driver change, and it may also be that new boots are needed on the car. Up and down the pit lane, driver changes, tyre changes, refuelling. Every pit stop will have refuelling in come what may, and two-part pit stops. You can do the driver change and fuel, nothing else. Then you can do tyres or any other work on the car. And there's a restriction on the number of mechanics that you can have working on the pit stops. Away goes number 16. So Andrea Puccini, curiously, towards the end of that stint, losing time. But let's see what Frank Stippler can do behind the wheel of that car. Frank, winner of the Nürburgring 24 hours this year, and also somebody who goes very, very well in historic racing. He's able to adapt between the two very effectively. Although the rain has stopped now, it's still a very wet circuit, and the amount of spray, of course, still very, very bad as well. So it remains a real challenge, this, for the drivers. As we've got the race currently on lap 120. And Andrea Puccini, having given that car over to Frank Stippler, will have possibly lost another place, won't he? Marco Bonanomi could rather be up to third down at the end of this next lap. The Pro-Am class lead has changed yet again because Jos Menton didn't seem to do a very long stint in that car, the number 24 Lamborghini. He's now given it to Albert von Thurman Taxis, and that now means that Nico Verdonk is in the lead of the Pro-Am class, running in fifth overall. Now, in number 66, you've got Frank Kettler, and ahead of him is the 23 United Autosports Audi that he's up alongside and then makes contact with. And he survives, does Frank Kettler, but that's another scare he could well do without. Right, Marco Bonanomi will not gain a place because he's now pitted as well. So as Puccini comes in to give way to Stippler, so in comes the number two Audi, Marco Bonanomi, to give the car back to the man that started it, Edward Sandstrom. And Sandstrom is, as we've seen in a number of races, somebody who's able to bring cars up from poor grid positions. He was 49th on the grid for last year's Spa 24, along with that Werner and Claudio Hurtgen got the car to second place. So there's number one Audi going through, Christopher Hasse at the wheel, Now, Maxime Martin, having taken over the lead of the race, is still doing laps that are the best part of 5 seconds quicker than the Audi. So, having stormed up onto the tail of the Audis, now he's pulling away once again. And Maxime Martin is underlining why people think he is the Don's Watsits in a GT car, because he's got the speed and he's not making mistakes either. I mean, even though he's going so much faster than anybody else in the dark, in the rain, he's not putting a wheel wrong. And so he's now leading by 16.4 seconds. He only got the lead 2 laps ago. That's what he's pulled out. Just astonishing, the pace of Maxime Martin. And again, this car proving that it's a real, real threat for a win. It was only at this event last year that Marc Vds started running a BMW Z4. Went well here, but it didn't win. But he did win the subsequent 2 races at Manicourt and Silverstone. And then it won again at Monza at the start of this year. And again at Silverstone for round 2 of this year's championship. And finished 2nd at Paul Ricard. So the team and the car and the combination of drivers all gelled together so well. And Bas Linders, who is the team principal for Marc Vds Racing, as well, of course, as the driver, sort of player-manager role that he fulfills, very, very keen indeed to try and score a victory here. And big rivalry between Marc Vds and the Belgian Audi club, Team WRT cars. There's a bit of support from Audi to the Belgian team, whereas there's only modest support from BMW to its customer programme. It's on a different level, really, from that of Audi. And so Marc Vds Racing very keen to put one over the old Belgian team here. There is number one, Christopher Hasse, in traffic, being delayed, and trying to work his way on this, the 121st lap of the race, with Frank Stippler hunting him down. We don't yet know what a Frank Stippler lap time is going to be like relative to Christopher Hasse, but Stippler third, hunting down the two ahead of him. So at the end of the next lap, when we start to see a proper lap time out of that car, we'll find out exactly how well it can go. It is 10:30 here at Spa for the Total 24 Hours of Spa, round 4 of the Blancpain Endurance Series. David Addison and Hayley Coxon trackside in a race that's had now 3 safety car periods. 1 thanks to a big crash for Philippe Salini, 2 because of the heavy rain, and the race being led by the number 3 Maxime Martin driven BMW. And it's a car that, in a sense, has already had a win in the race by taking the points available, the maximum points available at the 6-hour mark. All good for the championship. 2nd is the number 1, Christopher Hasse, Audi. 3rd, Frank Stippler's Audi. 4th, Edward Sandstrom, Audi. 5th, the best of the McLarens, going really well on home soil, this, the number 5, Boots and Junior racing car, which is now being shown. There's Nico Verdonk back behind the wheel of it, the car he shares with Edouard Mondrian, Jack Clark, and Eric Vanderpool, the man who has won the Spa 24 Hours more than anybody, 5 times a winner. Formula 1 racer for a time as well, Eric Vanderpool. And then in 6th place, you've got Greg Gilvert in the number 40 at Santalot Racing Audi, which is another car that has gone very, very strongly, and he's one that shouldn't be ruled out by the end. It's again a car from the Pro Cup. 3 drivers, therefore, Greg Gilvert, Dino Lenardi, and Audi DTM racer Philippe Albuquerque. And that car going very, very strongly as well at the moment. In 7th place is Frank Kettler, the pole man in the Vita 41 BMW. In 8th place is number 36, the BMW of DB Motorsport. It's gone back to your own Demboa. In 9th place is the number 24 Lamborghini of Gonzalo Montoya Taxis. And to round out the top 10, currently he's number 51, the AF Corsa Ferrari, with Dan Brown at the wheel. Dan, who was a real hero at Paul Ricard. It's a shame the car had gearbox problems, because he'd done a great stint to lead in the middle hour of the race. And Dan Brown, with Antonio Adonio Perez, Giuseppe Ciro, and Tony Villander, make a very, very good combination of drivers in Pro-Am. And that car, which was delayed early on because Tony Villander copped a 30-second stop-go penalty for a red flag infringement, he overtook people under the red flags on Thursday at the end of the session, that car is now coming back into contention. It's a couple of laps down on the overall leader, it's a lap down on the class leader, but if it gets through without a problem, that car, run by AF Corsa, who make very fast Ferraris, Amato Ferrari's team, that I think should be a potential class winner still come the end of the race tomorrow afternoon. 4 classes in the race. The Pro Cup, the Pro-Am Cup, which you're looking at the classification for now. You've also got the Gentleman Trophy for the older drivers, or the bronze and silver graded drivers running together. And then the Cup class for the bronze graded drivers in older machinery, which is the domain of Porsches. The intention is to try and tempt out some of the earlier Ferraris, like 360s, but we haven't got there yet. But we have got the 430 running in the Gentleman Trophy class, which Giacomo Puccini, Andrea Puccini's older brother, qualified on pole position in class for Kessel Racing on Thursday night. Some teams trying to grab a little bit of shut-eye before it gets really manic. But that's all well and good as long as your car is behaving itself. Some are, some aren't. Paddock is a busy place. into the endurance pits, the run down past Eau Rouge. In recent years, everything moved from that old pits up to the top prior to the source, where the F1 pits and the new race control building, and it's now where the bulk of races are run from at Spa, in fact. Although for the 24 hours, there's still that ceremonial start, really, in front of the endurance pits. The cars dive downhill into the Eau Rouge tradition. That still rules so far as that at Spa. Being a bit delayed there is the 47 ASM McLaren, which Karim Moget crashed in qualifying on Thursday. It has been repaired and is going very, very strongly. Car 59 has had another spin, apparently, and that's the Bonetti Giacato Lions Salacquada driven Ferrari. Getting itself back on. It was Blanchimont where the car went off, which is not a good place to go off the road. And Maxime Martin still storming on, being held up a little bit by Bettmarker, but look at the way he works his way through the traffic. Total confidence in the grip that he's going to have at the next corner, and confidence in the fact that Bettmarker's know that he's there, flashing the lights. Slower car doesn't get out of the way, and there's contact, and off there goes the number 9 Gulf Racing McLaren, and has the race leader got involved in that as well? That was going into Pouhon, and the McLaren spins off the road. Now, where did Maxime Martin end up in all of that? Has he survived? He has, but that was very close to disaster for him. Having just talked about the confidence he had to have in the traffic seeing him coming, the number 9 McLaren gets in the way. Mike Wainwright, the amateur driver at the wheel of that car, and distracted or spooked a bit by the car being so close behind him. We'll try and get a replay of that in a moment, but as the cars work their way down towards Pouhon, it looked as though the two cars may have touched, but certainly Mike Wainwright getting it wrong and going off the road. He may have had a tap, but all of a sudden, things didn't look quite so good for Maxime Martin. That could have spelt a big, big disaster for him. The BMW then carries on. And here it is, coming down the hill. So Maxime Martin flashes the lights. He lines up to go to the inside. Wainwright moves across, goes onto the grass, spins across the road, but he took Maxime Martin with him, and Maxime doesn't spin. He gets back onto the tarmac and finds some traction again, but he's very lucky, I reckon, to have survived that. That could have been a big, big scare for him. Maxime Martin, remember, is trying to build up this lead because it has to be taken at some point. There will be this stop-go penalty for Marcus Pautela. So even though he's getting away from Christopher Hasse, that gap to an extent will be negated when the car makes that extra stop, that longer stop, the stop-go penalty. So things are not quite as bad, maybe, as they look with Audi dropping away in second place, because inevitably the car will come back into the hunt. Although number 1 is in the pit lane now, Christopher Hasse is in. So the number 1 Audi down the pit lane. Is he going to stay behind the wheel? Is he going to give way to Christopher Mies? Is the next question. So Maxime Martin continues to lead the way, but it was a big scare that for the BMW. Marcus Pautela yet to get into the number 3 BMW. That means he's got time to talk to Hayley.
Max has certainly got a great lead in the BMW now, Marcus, which is definitely needed. When you get in the car, you do have that drive-through penalty. How are you feeling looking forward getting into the car?
Well, I've been thinking about the drive-through penalty now for 2 days, and it's time to think about the race. Of course, I still have to serve it. And that's actually why I haven't been in the car yet. So we wanted to be at the six-hour mark without my penalty, and it worked pretty well. And we might even go until 12 hours, but that means that I'm going to have a really, really busy Sunday then. So, but let's see, it's going really good now. We had only a small issue with one of the pit stops when Max got caught out with the red light at the pit exit. Sorry, and we lost out there to the two Audis, but at the moment he's flying and it's looking good.
So you really don't have any idea when you're going to be stepping into the BMW?
I've been ready since this morning, but it's probably going to be sometime during the night.
Thank you.
So Marcus Pautela will get his turn, but not just yet. But the first part of the plan has worked well, because as we've been making the point, the car was leading at the six-hour mark. Points have gone that way. Mike Heseman's just sitting to the right of Marcus Pautela there in the headset, who is, of course, one of the drivers of the sister car, number 4, which lost time early on in the race when the copper cable snapped. And it's 24th now, that car, Bert Longchamp, been behind the wheel most recently. kind of bringing it to contention, but that's another one that needs to sort of gain ground over the course of the race. It's not going to suddenly leap up the order. Wainwright has got going again after that tap, which we think came from the RVDS BMW, back on track. So the race currently is on lap 125. Maxime Martin continues to be the quickest man on the circuit, although the lap times that he's doing in the 245s now are being achieved by Edward Sandstrom once again, who's got himself behind the wheel of the number two Team WRT Audi. Winner of the Dubai 24 Hours last year, Edward Sandstrom. The winner of the Barcelona 24 Hours last year as well, and former single-seater racer before he went into GT cars. So Edwin Sandstrom now pushing on to good effect, and the fourth-place car started to creep up onto the tail of Frank Stippler, who is also not that far off a Maxime Martin pace. He's about a second a lap slower, which is not ideal, but it's not too far back. Whereas Christopher Mees is lapping in the 251s, having taken over the car now from Christopher Hauser, so give him a lap or two to play himself back in, get used to the conditions in the car, and then I'm sure things will start to improve for him as well. So as the cars work lap 125, Maxime Martin leading the way. There is the BMW number three. Well, VDS Racing having really taken the Blancpain Endurance Series by storm with those two wins at the end of last year, two wins and a second so far this year. Could it be a Spa 24 Hours win as well? It would be a very popular result, that's for sure. And pretty emotional one, I would have thought, for Jean-Michel Martin to see his son winning. Jean-Michel and his brother, in fact, used to team up to win the race in four Capri days, when Jean-Michel and Philippe Martin were the winners. And in four Capris, they took back-to-back wins, in fact, in 1979 and 1980. But can Maxime Martin score a 24-hour victory here as well? It's a long way to go, yep, with still over 17 hours of the race remaining. That's how the driver standings are now, with Linders, Martin and Peltier ahead of Hassett, Mees and Ortelli, with 80 to the BMW drivers, 57 to Hassett, Mees and Ortelli. Third in the championship now, Edward Sandstrom and Laurens Vanthoor, with Stefano Gattuso fourth, along with Davide Rigon and Daniel Zampieri. And we've not really dwelt on them much in the race so far because they haven't really been part of the battle. But the Kessel Racing team had a big off on Thursday, badly damaged the car, and effectively a new car had to be brought for them. But 71 is down in 34th place. I mean, barely trouble the scorers, as they say, because of this. It's been a very subdued Ferrari, and is still a long, long way back, having had earlier dramas, lots of time lost. So 71 is not going to do hugely well in terms of the overall classification. Because of the numbers of cars in the Pro Cup, it's not as numerically strong as Pro-Am, then it'll help them, because even though it's a bad overall result, it'll be decent enough in class to get some points out of the race, but it's far from ideal. Interesting the way that the way Pro Cup is BMWs and Porsches and Audis and McLarens, but only that one Ferrari, whereas Pro-Am has lots and lots of Ferraris in it. But just the one car within the Pro Cup in the Blancpain Endurance Series. There's the leading BMW heading through Les Combes, and Maxime Martin leading the way. And of course, he has been able to recover from that drama he had with Mike Wainwright in the McLaren. So Maxime Martin swooping his way through traffic as best he can, running his way past back markers. So Martin on that 126. Down towards Quan. Turns his way through the corner, hunting for grip, goes to the outside of the road. So that's safely through Point, whereas a few laps ago, flashing his lights at Mike Wainwright, goes to the inside. Wainwright just moves across and completely misjudges the corner and where the car was, gets on the wet grass. He spins off the road, goes onto the runoff on the outside. And this is Maxime Martin's view as he turns into the corner, and suddenly this McLaren moves across the front of him. That in turn goes off. Maxime Martin is able to survive it all, But there, the McLaren, it's almost as though Mike Wainwright just completely missed the corner and thought it was much closer to him. He turned in and came across the front of the BMW. And there, a wheel off somebody, and that, I fear, may be at La Source. It is. We've got two cars off, one of which is number five. That's the car that was leading the Pro-Am Cup. The Pro-Am Cup class-leading McLaren has gone, and 62 is off as well. And that's had a really miserable race because Klaus Hummel has taken the car over from Phil Quaife, who's taken it over from the now excluded Adam Christodoulou. They've come to grief. Now, whose car has shed the wheel? Because you ain't going to get a three-wheel car back to the pits from there, that's for sure. But the two of them off together at La Source. So there's a yellow flag there. But now we need to try and do some damage assessment. But the really significant part of that is that number five, Nico Verdonk at the wheel, the class-leading car that was in fifth place, is off the road. And it's kind of hemmed in, isn't it, by having 62 up alongside it and behind. And Nico Verdonk, I think, wants a word with Klaus Hummel. He is not impressed by whatever has happened at the first corner. So he's out of the car, but he's giving the other McLaren driver a piece of his mind. So the cars need to be moved out of harm's way. Can they get back into the race? How bad is the damage? If I were Klaus Hummel, I think I'd stay in that car if I'm safer there. Because if Nico Verdonk is allowed to go and have a word with him, the mood he's in looking at this, going to be restrained by the marshals and led away. He is a very irate driver, and understandably, home race, leading the class, and he's got involved somehow with a back marker and has gone off the road. But that needs piecing together somehow. So the class leading number five McLaren off the road. They need moving out of harm's way, and I just wonder whether this might be another safety car period. It's number 62 that's lost the wheel. So that wheel we saw bouncing over the track at La Source has come off number 62. So is there a chance that the number 5 McLaren might be able to rejoin? Well, Nico Verdonk has calmed down. Safety car is being deployed yet again. It's because of this drama at La Source with two cars off by the edge of the circuit. It is pretty dangerous, to be fair. And so that's our fourth safety car period of the race. We'll have a look and try and piece together what we can and what we know. Right, spot the headlights. To the inside, Klaus Hummel goes to the inside and bounces off Nico Verdonk's car, and they go through the corner and run wide, but it was on the inside seemingly that Klaus Hummel was. The wheel has come across the road, he stopped. You can see the damage on the left hand side of the car, but that impact I think would have done quite a bit of damage to the right hand side of Nico Verdonk's car. And there is the wheel that just manages to avoid clobbering 66 Frank Kettler's BMW. That's pretty close. And the number 66 BMW has just bagged sixth and come down the pit lane under the safety car to try and claw back some time. So those two McLarens need to be taken off the circuit, out of harm's way. And Nico Verdonk is absolutely furious. It didn't look as though he had much to do with that. He was on the outside line, and Klaus Hummel seemed to be on the inside, missed his breaking point and hit him. And so the 62 McLaren is fast becoming a pretty unpopular car. The only person that we've not seen in it yet, I think, is Tim Mullen. Therefore, he's the only person that's not had a problem in it. Adam Christodoulou has had his accident. Phil Quaife's had a spin. Klaus Hummel has now had his dramas. Tim Mullen might well be heading for the bar. Can't avoid anything to do with that car now because it's had a pretty checkered race. Safety car on track. Frank Kettler is in the pit lane. And refueling has been done. The car's just gone up on the jacks. So, the safety car, which I think is also going to get a good haul of points out of this race, given the number of laps it's done. It's well placed overall, no doubt. He's back on track, and it will hopefully pick up the leading car, which is Maxime Martin. But, of course, that gap Maxime has been trying to build up will now be reduced, because under the safety car, everybody bunches up, and so the advantage that the BMW had is going to be brought down again. So the field reduces its pace, and the two safety cars back on track, leading everybody around. This safety car period shouldn't be that long, a safety car period, in as much as it's not to do with the weather, it's purely to get these damaged cars out of the way. And, of course, you can just go straight across the track from La Source into the endurance pits and get them back into the paddock and out of the way. But two more retirements then with the damage. And the most significant part of that is the demise of the number 5 McLaren. Now, what that does is put Prince Albert von Turn on Taxis into the lead now of the Pro-Am class, up into 8th place overall. It also gives number 51, Dan Brown, a chance of getting himself into second in the class, because next lap through he will inherit that place from Nico Verdon, whose car, as you now know, is stranded out by the side of the circuit. There is Klaus Hummel's car being taken away, and as we look at that, let's go down to the pit lane. Hayley, what news have you got for us?
Hey, Adders, yeah, I just have a little bit of an update on that number 5 McLaren. I've just spoken to the team. All the other drivers are actually sleeping at the moment, but the team have just commented saying that Klaus Hummel, they believe, ran the number 5 off the track, and they believe, obviously, you can see they've lost a tyre, but the chassis damage also, and they're very, very disappointed the race is over.
Well, if they're saying it's over, then that is bad news. By the sound of it, no chance of the driver Nico Verdon getting the car back from there. Thanks, Hayley. Very disappointing news, because the team, having got itself into the lead of the class, make the point again, Belgian team, Belgian race, Belgian drivers, and the car now out of the race. But Klaus Hummel being accused by the team of ramming it off the road effectively, well, there's the damage to the side of 62. We haven't yet seen the damage on the other side of number 5 McLaren, but it's not looking good. Hopefully the flatbed's going to miss it. Yeah, I think it will. And a very, very sorry state, but number 62 McLaren is no more. That's the end of that. And then they need to get Nico Verdonk's car off the circuit as well. So into the lead of the class is now Albert Maria Lamoral, Miguel Johannes Gabriel Prince von Turner, Texas. Or as the timing screen has him, Tut, because that's much simpler to have on there than his rather long-winded name. And the Blancpain rider Lamborghini leads the way. And it's in 8th place overall, Crown Class leading car. Dan Brown is up in the AF Corsa Ferrari to 2nd in class, 9th overall now. And you can see the queue of cars coming down the pit lane, but somebody coming in incredibly slowly, as though the car was struggling to move there, and that's held everybody up behind. What's with this about? There's like a traffic jam at the end of the pit lane, people coming to an absolute stop. That's the inside of the Lasseur's hairpin. 42 comes in. That's the Ferrari, to be operated by the Sport Garage team. The Romain Brandella, Leon Camol, Kevin Despanes, Michel Petit car. And the driver change effected, the fuel going in. So, again, a car for the Pro-Am class. Taking the opportunity to pit while we have the reduced pace like this. 47th when it came in. Romain Brandella being the man that brought the car down the pit road. Bit of damage on the front of it there, you can see. Team happy, I think. Yep, engine to be fired up in a moment. Or do they need a new set of tyres on that car? It looks like it's going to go. Rather more relaxed pace in the pit lane for this car. A team that just wants to get it home, I think, keep out of trouble. Another good stint done by Romain Brandella. Very rapid French GT racer, and also somebody that's been busy in historic racing in his time as well, in things like early T70s and Chevron B8. So, versatile driver, that's for sure. And the number 5 McLaren being taken away. Nico Verdon, somebody that maybe Hayley will be brave enough to go and talk to once he's calmed down. But you can see the way that he was absolutely livid with Klaus Hummel for that incident going into La Source. So yet again we have the safety car on track, and we've got the Maxime Martin BMW leading the way. It's BMW from Audi, from Audi, from Audi, from Audi, from BMW, because you've got them in 6th place. Now you're in Den Boer, number 36, BMW up in the mix. 7th is the Lamborghini of Albert Montour on taxis, 8th the BMW of Frank Kettler, 9th Dan Brown's Ferrari, 10th now Nick Homerson in the sister AF Corsa Ferrari. So, familiar sight, safety cars on track at Spa today. McLaren's on flatbeds, another sadly familiar sight, as there the number 5 McLaren is about to be taken back to the paddock with Nico Verdon now out of the race. Let's remind ourselves of how the race has got to this point. At 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it was sunny, it was dry, and it was the start. And Maxime Martin led the way with a really brave move around the outside, going through Arouge, hung on to the line, heading up Radion onto the Kemmel Straight, and it was the Mark VDS BMW ahead of Frank Kekler, Alvaro Perez third, and Nico Verdon was running in 4th place. Andre Loftre, though, after a poor qualifying, working his way up the order and was busy battling with Ben Schneider. And you compare now some of the drivers involved in the early part of the race with cars that have since had big problems and dropped away, and it looks like a completely different event altogether, doesn't it? With Ben Schneider's Mercedes no more, with the Nico Verdonk McLaren no more, with André Loffler's car badly delayed. We'll get to that in a moment, because there were battles all the way through the field. Porsche squabbling amongst themselves, Ferrari taking on McLaren's, and with one or two of the teams having almost self-destructed over the course of the race so far. One man you can always rely on to entertain, Uwe Altensen, and he was having a real battle with Peter Cox in the Lamborghini in the early part of the race. Matt Griffin was losing out in a straight line because of a broken bonnet catch. The car just didn't have the pace in a straight line. But Xavier Martin in the Pro Speed Porsche pushing on and worked his way past the battered car of Olivier Plard with its flapping rear bodywork going up towards Le Combe. Frank Kekler was pushing hard in the early part of the race, doing his best to stay on terms with Maxime Martin. But the Belgian driver just that bit faster as Jaap van Lagen spun the race art BMW into the barriers. Dramas also for Koen Wouters. He was attacked by the Jochen Habert-driven BMW. It put Koen Wouters in the gravel and then to the pit lane with suspension damage. Habert's had a puncture as well and he limped in for repairs. André Loffler found himself in a battle with the Aston Martin in the hands of Bertrand Baguette. The Aston Martin too has had big problems since and fallen out of contention altogether. But Loffler couldn't find a way past the fellow prototype racer. Bertrand Baguette keeping him at bay. Koen Wouters had another lock-up, ran wide, enabling the Tony Villander Ferrari to go through. Villander, this stage, about to be lapped by the leader, getting in the way. And then the first major drama, as Adam Christodoulou tried to go for the pit lane and moved across the front of André Loffler, who had no option, therefore, but to come down the pit lane with his damage. But for this, Adam Christodoulou excluded from the race. Lorenzo Bontempelli had a punctured tyre and limped the 72-458 Italia back to the pit lane. Frank Kekler came up on the traffic, and ahead of him he encountered the Lorenz Frey-driven Jaguar being attacked by the Santillac Audi and turned around in the middle of the bus stop. The Jaguar got going again, but an electrical problem has since put that car out of the race, and the 66 starters is starting to dwindle. The number one Audi of the Christophers, Mies and Hasse and Stefan Ortelli, in the second stint became a much more competitive car, while Uwe Altensen still had his right foot nailed to the floor and worked his way past back markers and also the number two Edward Sandstrom Audi. David Jones was being mugged with his stints in the pressure spark misfiring Mercedes as the United Autosports Audi very nearly was hit by the number 36 BMW at the bus stop. More dramas out on track as the Debbie Tuchman Porsche got involved with the GT3 racing Audi. Then, as Edward Sandstrom had lapped the Mercedes of Kenneth Hyre, he outbraked himself at the bus stop and lost the place again. And then Peter Belshaw came under attack from the Maxime Soulet driven Porsche. Great racing was going on in the dry, in the daylight, with Edward Sandstrom keeping at bay Stefan Lemery, but Frank Stippler was charging along behind them. He picked off one, he picked off two, going into Le Combe. McLaren's almost coming to blows. Eric van der Poel was attacked by Alvaro Parent. The order didn't change, but it did four corners later. Parent up on the inside. And of course, since then, we've lost the orange McLaren, Eric van der Poel. A five times winner of the Spa 24 Hours, now out of the race. Into the pits came the Inferno Porsche, as down the pit lane limped number 33. The mechanics were there with the extinguishers to put out the blaze as Eric Desmont arrived with the back of the car well alight, and that was a retirement. Then the rain started to come down in earnest. Off the road went car number 60, Julian Draper. Phil Quaife lost 62 as he slithered off the road, and the safety car was deployed to control the pace. That enabled one or two teams to make their pit stops, but it was a long, long safety car period because of the fact that the standing water on the road was a big, big issue. Eventually things improved enough to get things back underway. And as they did so, the lead battle continued between the number three Mark VDS Racing BMW and the number one Team WRT Audi and the number 16 Audi in the hands of Andrea Puccini. There were more pit stops, there was more shuffling, and as each car, three from one from 16, pitted, so the lead changed to another car. It was handing the baton, a across the three leaders, and this battle potentially is going to continue right the way to the end of the race. As darkness descended, then the battle has continued for the lead, and Fastlinders lost out to a charging Christopher Hasse, who squeezed his way by on the inside, working his way through the bus stop. Another safety car period needed because of the bad weather. We had another one just before that because of Philip Salamy having a big off in his Porsche. And with the rain falling once again, everybody queued up behind the safety car. Racing got underway, and Maxime Martin stormed his way back into contention and took over the lead of the race. And significantly, the number three BMW was leading the way at the 6 hour mark. Therefore, points went the way of Marc VDS Racing, enabling the team to enhance its stranglehold, really, on the Blancpain Endurance Series. Frank Kettler got involved in his next stint with the United Autosports Audi. And then Maxime Martin very nearly got wiped out completely by the Gulf Racing McLaren and Mike Wainwright, who seemed to completely misjudge where the corner was, moved across in front of the leader. He went off the road, but Maxime Martin leads a charmed life, as you see from the onboard. But somehow he managed to avoid disaster and stay not only in the race, but also in the lead. And then at La Source, Klaus Hummel at the inside of Nico Verdonk and eliminated both McLarens, the Verdonk car a class leader. So that covers pretty much what has been happening so far within the Spa 24 hours. And there we've got the concert starting. The fans now heading towards the concerts. Faithless, as we've been saying, playing here at Spa. And on track, battles continue across the classes. Disappointingly, one car that we're not going to see very much more of is the Mercedes that was the best placed Mercedes in last year's race, the Pressy Spark car run by Team Pyro of Bernd Schneider, the five times DTM champion, former Formula One racer, who has been working with these young aspiring drivers, David and Godfrey Jones and Mike Jordan. And Mike Jordan has joined me in the booth now to explain what's gone on, Mike, because you had such high hopes. The car was, you were telling me, so good after qualifying, and it's all come to a sorry end. What's gone wrong? So you thought you'd go and watch?
or go and watch Maxi. So, right. An electrical problem.
Yes, right.
We got a little bit of fire from the very beginning that burned. We thought it was a fuel pump, so he switched fuel pumps in the early stages. Did the same for David, and when Godfrey was under pace car, for that long pace car, it was getting worse and worse. And we were going to change the ECU in the stop when I got in, and it wouldn't start, basically, before we did anything like that.
Right.
So I pressed the button, and I sat there rambling in through my mind, have I actually pressed the right button, have I switched everything on? And the team looked at me as though, silly old tosser, he doesn't even know how to start the car now. You get those looks. But unfortunately, there's something gone in the chassis loom on the car, I think. So
right.
They've tried everything, and the Mercedes guys, they actually haven't realised that we've all left, and they're still working
in the garage
on it. Because they're in the footwell of the car. Tino's lying down there with the head torch on, working away, and we've all now gone.
Right, fine. The Joneses no doubt have found a good rest rule. They're enjoying life.
Opened after they were pretty fed up, actually, because they did have great high hopes for this. And David just opened a bottle of beer and said, I'm off to get ratted.
Okay.
So that was that. So me being the saddo, I'm now going to be an anorak and go and walk the whole way around the circuit on my own because everybody else has gone, including Andrew.
Fair enough. Well, don't go just yet because, first of all, I want some opinions on a few things. We've just seen a drive-through penalty board being given to the number four BMW because you've got Bert Longjean behind the wheel and apparently he has exceeded the driving time allowed because you can only do 65 minutes in a stint or 70 if there's a safety car. And we've also seen number 73 Ferrari stop at the end of the pit lane. Let's just cover this driving time thing first. How does a professional team get something like that wrong?
But there were quite a few who did it last year, weren't they? And it's almost gambling that you want to extend it because you want to have your minimum stop time all the time. Wow, that's a bad place to be pulled up.
That's pit in, and it's lost a wheel, apparently. Now, you can just about nip round the front of that, but it's in almost the worst possible place.
Well, not quite as bad as the one that was pulled up on the exit from Eau Rouge earlier on, was it? That was a scary bit of footage with those cars ducking out from behind it. No, I think everybody's just pushing the envelope, Sam. This is so damn competitive, this series, isn't it?
Yeah.
And some of the guys will run it to try and get the car landed within the timescale on the 65 minutes. Now, if you catch somebody on your inlap, if there's a yellow flag or if you catch a group of slow cars, you could be a few seconds wrong. I mean, we've made the decision. Adam Hardy, our engineer, had made the decision. He was, in the early stage of this, he was always going to keep one lap in his pocket. We weren't going to run it that close because that could happen. Certainly, if you were, you know, if we were having a race like we had last year where you were challenging for a podium, then you would do that. You just push the boat out. But a lot of them... There's so many quick people in this, isn't it? You can't leave anything on the table.
Now that Ferrari we've just seen that's ground to a halt, three-wheeled at the end of the pit lane, was leading the Gentleman Trophy class. We've been going for 6 hours and change, and it seems as though nobody really wants to finish this race because there's a huge amount of cars self-destructing, aren't there?
There are. I've got to say, because we've all been working on the car and throwing in all sorts of you know, helpful tips to the AMG guys. You know, have you tried the condenser and does it need a new set of points?
Yeah.
But they didn't seem to grasp that one at all. So I'm a bit out of touch with what's going on, but it was interesting just watching some of the stuff that you were going through there. It's been a fascinating race up until now.
The weather has been pretty lousy, hasn't it? I mean, you've raced here a number of times. Have you known it as bad as this?
Probably not. I mean, that first downpour when we were actually... Godfrey was going in the car at that point, and see, that's where we should be. We should be boogieing, shouldn't
we? You're missing
this. I'm missing it. Yeah. You know, at my age, I'm still.
You're down with the kids, I can tell, Mark.
Absolutely, yeah. Man. That was.
this is all part, isn't it, of the Spa 24 Hours? I mean, yes, saddos want to watch cars and walk around the circuit, but there's a whole different audience who have got in one hand a beer, a cone of Freak in the other, and they're at a concert. What more do you want?
Well, Richard Hayes just said to me, he said, I bet Andrew's down there. No, I think I bet Andrew's probably in a bar with a load of the grid girls at the minute. No, probably go there later.
Actually, Jazz is a proper racer. I mean, he raced Porsches. You know about Porsches?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
They don't break.
No.
That's Mark Hayat getting ready to take over the Lamborghini. Right, back to this weather, back to this Spa element. Yeah, we know it's going to rain at Spa. There's a reason why it's got all these lush green trees around here. It's because they get watered quite regularly. But the race director has a thankless task, doesn't it? Because some people will say, oh, you don't need a safety car. It's up to the drivers on their right foot. But, I mean, it has been really bad, that rain.
I love it when people say that, and they've probably not gone and done it. At times when the safety car would definitely be the fastest car out there, so... Eduardo has a very difficult job, and you'd have to say that one earlier, I was looking at that wondering whether he would actually even have to suspend the race. It was that bad, but hey, everybody's doing okay now. I mean, it was horrible obviously at the beginning of that period of the rundown to La Source when cars were going off. When it's that bad, it doesn't matter how good you are, it's just an element of luck.
Now here you've got the class leading Lamborghini back into the lead of its class. Albert von Turn on Taxis giving way to Mark Hayek, the CEO of Blancpain. Now, of course, this is the class that you were racing in, the Pro-Am class, and this is where the opposition have now got to, sixth overall. And, of course, the Pro-Am class, you've got so many fast drivers in there, it's massively competitive. And, of course, these cars could well get themselves up, you know, to the podium by the end of the race.
I think they will. I mean, the Pro-Am now, it's more pro and a little bit of am, isn't it?
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
it is incredibly serious. And I noticed on SRO's press release yesterday, they said they were going to try and encourage more teams to go into the Gentleman Trophy class for next year. Really, if you could be, by allowing them the latest cars and only being bronze or a silver driver if you're over 40. So I could see it being that would have quite an attraction because some of the Pro-Am stuff is now very, very serious.
Indeed so. And we have got the safety car out again, according to the timing screen. I'm assuming this is because of that Ferrari at the end of the pit lane and they just can't move it. And you need to get everybody scooped up to deploy a racket truck to get it out of the way. But that's the fifth safety car of the race that we've had. And the safety car, I think, is now classified 18th overall or something, because it's doing pretty well in this race, isn't it?
I mean, it's Audi, isn't it? So it's going to do well, isn't it?
Well, that's true. Dr. Wolfgang Ulrich was interviewed earlier on, and he did make the point that, of course, the safety car is a quattro.
Yeah.
It's a four-wheel drive. That's why it's good in the rain. Nobody else can keep up.
Absolutely. Did anything come to light from earlier on from the Adam Christodoulou thing? Obviously, I heard that he'd been excluded from that. Had he had a pit call there? Or does
Don't know about that. It looked as though he wanted to come in, certainly, and wasn't aware, perhaps, of where Andre Lotterer's Audi was around him. What did you think about that? Did you think it was purely down to him? His fault?
I'm a huge fan of Adam Christodoulou. I think he's got a massive future in front of him, and I was so disappointed to see that piece of paper that he'd been excluded. I found it a very strange one. I couldn't understand whether he perhaps didn't realise where the Audi was. He'd looked to go around the outside of Bernd, I thought, realised he couldn't do that, and maybe was trying to cut back to get under him coming off the bus stop, or he'd got a call for the pits, because he seemed to definitely go straight for a while, as though he was heading for the pits. But he's a great kid and a fantastic driver, and it's so sad for him.
And that car, as you've probably seen, he's out of the race as well now, because Phil Quaife had a spin with it, and Klaus Hummel then made a moment at La Source and has eliminated the Nico Verdonk, Jack Clark, Eric van der Poel car, which therefore is no more eliminated from its class lead. So that 62 McLaren has been in a bulk of incidents. Phil Quaife had his spin in the rain, now Klaus Hummel off the road as well. So, I don't think some people are going to be sad to see the back of it.
Sounds like it's been in the wars a bit, isn't it? Right. And it is difficult, isn't it? You know, for somebody like Klaus Hummel that's, you know, a good gentleman driver and obviously doing a very good job on how he's putting his team together and that. But you get into this sort of environment at this track with these amount of cars and a lot of the pro cars, they're obviously very aggressive with their moves, so that, you know, the Audis, they've got the light flashes on you from sort of half a mile back, and it can be a very distracting scenario.
Well, we saw that, didn't we, a few moments ago in the highlights. Mike Wainwright in the McLaren suddenly moving across in front of the race leader as though he knew there was a corner coming up, was a bit distracted by the lights and sort of lost where the corner was, where the runoff was, where the grass was, and just turned in too early.
It's very, very, very easy to do that. And I do think some of the guys with their light flashes, when they put them on so early, I try myself, not that we'll be doing it tonight, but if you're right behind somebody, use them then. But if you're using them all the time as soon as there's any car ahead, it effectively loses its effect, doesn't it? All it's doing is distracting people, and you don't really know then how close somebody is. Are they going to get past you at that corner, or are they going to wait a corner?
Or you back off very early and you compromise your own race because you're always waiting for the next faster car to come by. This safety car period, of course, inevitably is bunching up everybody, with now the two Audis, second and third, Christopher Meese and Frank Stippler, getting themselves together. The gap has come right down. Of course, it will do so under the safety car like this because of the fact that everyone gets bunched up and pace is reduced. Maxime Martin, though, in the BMW, I don't know how much of his stint you've been watching, Mike, but in the rain, I mean, he was lapping something like, at one point, nearly 10 seconds a lap quicker than anybody else, which is just massively impressive. And fresh out of the Lamborghini is Prince Albert von Turn und Taxis. He's handed the car back to Blancpain CEO Mark Hayek, and he's with Hayley.
We spoke to you before you got in the car. You're a little bit nervous, but excited to get in.
Really hard mode, to be honest. Now the end was okay.
Well, for the moment, I'm afraid we're not quite going to hear what Prince Albert von Turn und Taxis has to say. We'll get back to him in a moment as the concert remains in full swing and the fans at Spa turn their attention to that, as you can see why the safety car is out, with the pit in blocked. How you lose a wheel getting there, I'm not quite sure. Whether there's been an accident into the bus stop, someone's hit that Ferrari, Mike, and it's taken the wheel off, maybe.
Yeah, you would imagine so. You would think it probably is that, wouldn't you? Because it's certainly not going to be... You know, if you have a loose wheel, you lose it much earlier around the lap than that if you had just had a pit stop. Or if you had a hub failure, you'd favour that's had a bit of contact there. If what you're saying about Martin was on a like-for-like basis, that's embarrassing for a lot of other guys, isn't it? You've got somebody in a similar car doing you by 10 seconds.
It's massively... I know we know Spa, and there's local knowledge, and it's Belgian to him and all of that, and they've also got to try and build up a lead now negated because they've got a third driver yet to get into the car who's got a stop-go penalty to take. But even so, that is hugely impressive, isn't it?
But you can come up with all the reasons of why it might be, and all that local knowledge and that. It's 10 seconds a down lap. Yeah, that's fantastic.
Pierre Giudone at Silverstone, when the cars dropped back in the last hour, said, well, it's because Maxime Martin was in the BMW. I mean, that was it. You know, just shrugged his shoulders and said, you know, so good. And you can't even call him the secret weapon anymore because everybody knows how good he is. Other drivers, Frank Kettler at the press conference on Thursday, acknowledged that Martin was just the best GT3 driver there was. So for as long as Marc VDS can keep hold of him, he's doing great guns. Great shame, of course, also, that incident with Adam Christodoulou has affected the chances of the André Loftre and Marcel Fassler Tom Christensen car. There are some people that say, oh, you know, that car shouldn't be here, it's a worked car. But irrespective of that, the attention it brings to the race with double and back-to-back winners in Fassler and Loftre, plus Tom Christensen, who's just a legend of sports car racing, I think he's all good.
Yeah, I mean, I know this championship is, you know, not for works teams, and those may say that those garages at the end of the Formula One pits here, it looks very much like an Audi Works team, but what are they bringing to it? As you say, those names, you know, I walked up the grid earlier on, and you just look at a lot of the names on those cars up there, and it's just doing this championship and GT3 racing so much good. So,
absolutely.
But you shouldn't not have people in because they're very good and they do the job properly.
I want to ask you about the grid. Doors, McLaren's. Even before the race started, apparently, you were attacking Gulf Racing McLaren's. What's all this about, Vandal?
Well, I was. I wasn't.
Wasn't you?
No, and it wasn't David or Godfrey either, so there's the thing. No, Bernd was coming carefully through the gap between the cars behind, and one of the Gulf McLaren's opened his door, which obviously is...
Gullwing. Yeah.
And it went up and caught on our rear wing, and ours being a Mercedes just brushed it past with a little kiss on the carbon, and I think they broke the door hinge. Which
yes.
It was one of those slightly frustrating moments, with a bit like being stuck in traffic where you're not going to give way then, because they didn't want to put their door down, and I think we didn't want to go backwards, so there was a bit of a standoff on the grid before we'd started.
Great. That car's still going, by the way.
Thanks very much. His door will fall off in a minute, then I'll laugh.
The car in question is 20th now. Jamie Campbell-Walter at the wheel. And yours, retired, is now being shown as 60th. So,
draws. It's a long race. It's a long race. We could come back from this. And the Mercedes guys, on my way out, when I'm going out to party, I will go and see if they're still at it. Because they'll probably say, hey, Mike, we fixed it now. Do you want to get your kit back on?
You say, no, I'll offer a walk in the woods. I'll go to a concert. So, as the safety car continues, a word about Spa, because over the years, it's changed a little bit. There's more Formula One safety runoff. You've got these tarmac areas rather than the grass, but it's still an awesome circuit, isn't it?
It's a fantastic circuit, and, yeah, that sort of stuff right where they are, where they are there. That, you know, you've seen a lot of cars in the past end up in the gravel trap there, and it can finish your race.
Yeah.
So, I've got to say, for this race... while I don't like sanitised circuit, you know, I'm a fan of Cadwell Park or Castle Coombe, as we were both there last week.
Sure.
So what was it? Castle Coombe in a Honda last week and here with Bernd Schneider in a Mercedes this week.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you were at both.
You finished second in a Honda Integra.
I did.
You're not going to finish this.
But I think for this sort of race, it's good because it tries to minimise the amount of cars that are off in the gravel track. With you saying back there, isn't... JCW doing a good job in that McLaren.
Absolutely. It's good to have him in this category as well, isn't it? Because he's another proper GT driver.
You know, since his time with Lister, obviously, you know, little bit of prototype stuff that probably with Manassian was
drive with him in Lister.
Yeah, we won my only ever GT1 race at the Nürburgring.
That's right. It's
But he stepped up to that and done a really damn good job. I think he's opened a few people's eyes around that team as well.
And the sad thing is that he's not going to do the other two races of the year because there's not really room for him for the three-hour races. But hopefully he'll do some more with the team at the end of the year in the non-championship races and early next year. But, yeah, he's kind of been forgotten about, hadn't he, after the prototype era?
Yeah, and he is, I think he probably had quite a hard time in the creation prototype up against Manassian, because Manassian was very much at the top of his game in that sort of stuff, and Jamie hadn't done a lot of sports cars with aero on. You know, in a GT car, he's fantastic, and he's really shown his talent bloody well here.
Absolutely, and of course then also prototype racing, you then got the manufacturers in, so he's trying to go well in that car, and the team in general is nowhere near going to have the resource of Audi and then of Peugeot, and so it was always going to be a big, big struggle, wasn't it?
They did a good job. If you remember, they did that documentary, didn't they, Road to Le Mans at Legion Creation, and it was on a relatively modest budget, as any budget doing a prototype at Le Mans can be. But so it was a tough ride, I think that was.
McLaren generally are looking much improved compared to the start of the year. I mean, they're still perhaps not winning cars, but they're nearer to the outright pace than they were.
I think their outright pace is very good. You know, you obviously, without being rude to them, you questioned initially some of their reliability, but their pace is very good now. But if you looked at that grid, you've got to say that the overall balance of performance is pretty darn good now. The spread through there of the Z4s and Porsches and McLarens. You put somebody like Schneider in the Mercedes and that's there. So I think it's pretty good at the minute. It didn't look like too dominated by any one mark, did it?
No,
there were some very strong cars. I think that, you know, if you looked at speed traps, the McLaren very fast in a straight line, but excellent speed up there. Maybe it hasn't quite got the aero on in some of the other places because its speed was very, very good.
even though people are saying, yes, you've got the Mark VDS BMW having won two out of three races, both those wins were surprises because, you know, the first one, it came from way back on a circuit, Monza, that didn't suit that car. And at Silverstone, it was a surprise win in some respects as well because it was not the fastest car in qualifying. The safety car is going to be in at the end of this lap. We're also being told that we've got a very slow number 52 Ferrari on the circuit, and that's significant. We'll get to that in a moment. It's in 10th place. But before that, let's go back down to the pit lane. Hayley has found Prince Albert von Thurn on taxis again.
Albert, we spoke to you before you got in the car. You've just got out. How was your stint?
Good, you have to say, because we're leading the class now. And I had no mistakes, fortunately, in the stint. I really struggled in the first half. The rain was okay. It was not so strong rain, but on the backside of the circuit, especially towards Blanchimont, the whole fast bit, full speed bit, there was barely any side at all. So I was really just hoping you had the track limits right. And that was quite scary, I have to say. Toward the end of the stint, we were struggling quite hard with the grip. I think we've tried to drive one set of tires as long as we could. And we were now on our third stint on that same rain tire. And I think we have to just now, under these conditions, use newer and newer tires every stint, because I don't think that the tire allows multiple stints anymore.
Thank you.
So, having led the class, that car now is down a second in its class because number 50, Raffaele Giammaria, has taken over the lead of the class on that most recent pit stop. Right, we're about to go racing once again, and the safety car will head for the pit lane. And this long, long line of headlights is about to come storming over the line. Safety car's got the lights out. And so at the end of, for the race leader, lap 136, we're about to go back to racing once again. Out of the bus stop they come, over the timing line. Safety car peels in. Drivers start to overtake as they charge up towards La Source. The road drier. There's a bit less spray than there was, but you've still got to be hugely brave here, diving down to La Source. Your first lap at race pace, trying to work your way through traffic. It's still pretty tough for the drivers, this one.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, one of the helps that all of these GT3 cars have got now is that they all run a very sophisticated OBS system. Mm. So it does make life a little bit easier when it's like this. The Mercedes one is, everybody runs basically the Bosch Motorsport system, which is a tunable OBS system. So in these conditions, the chances of the horrible feeling of the front wheels locked up and you see that gap disappearing and somebody's turning into an airbag in front of you is less likely to happen. But obviously you're losing tyre temperature, you know, even on the wet trekking around behind the safety car, you do your best to do that. Interesting, one car ducking in off straight into the pit lane. We were discussing that just before I came up here, that seems a little bit of a tactic that one or two of them use, that rather than risking going half a lap down, getting held on pit exit, if you want to get something done under safety car, they're doing it straight off the restart and then getting clear space. So yeah. It's a different tactic that one or two of the teams are using.
Yeah, it's interesting, of course, because it's such a long pit lane here. It's a very long stop, isn't it, for even a drive-through. There you've got the number one Audi in the midst of all of the traffic. That's the second place car. Christopher Meese at the wheel of it, trying to dive past the inside Racing Ferrari, which he does round the outside there, going down towards speaker corner, the left-hander. And that's pretty brave, because that's a narrow part of the circuit.
It is, and the exit curve's extremely slippery there. So, you know, even, again, all these cars have got a very sophisticated traction control system on, but wet painted curbs, the traction control won't arrest you with any lateral load.
And the other element of this, as they say, is safety cars breed safety cars, because of course you put the safety car out for one incident, you bunch everybody up, you release them together, and it can all kick off again.
It's always the case, isn't it? You know that that's going to happen. Wow, this is a really good race then.
Now you're riding at the moment with Christopher Meese. This is the man that's second in the race, and ahead of him, loads of back markers. In this, of course, he's trying to work out where the corners are, where he can go by, where there might be some grip to do the overtaking. It's a pretty fraught life.
It is, and you know, certainly in the pro classes, where you see all of the sort of slightly less experienced guys in the Audi, not Tom Christensen, they're obviously all wanted to impress Dr. Ulrich, aren't they?
Yeah,
so
true.
So you know, all the time they don't want to be the one that does one slow lap, because they're always trying to justify their existence of why they should move up the ladder. You're laughing at me, but that's it. It's got to be maximum attack all the time. So that's where you see some fairly bold moves going on from those guys.
And then they have to remember that it's a 24-hour race, and they're not going to get much recognition for binning it. But so far, most of the Audis have kept out of trouble. It's ironic, isn't it? It's the favoured one of Andre Lotterer that's the one that's had the biggest dramas and has fallen down the order. So there Christopher Meek goes over the timing line, and that lap that he's done is a 2:51. So back to the kind of right pace for these conditions. What we need to see is where he is in relation to Maxime Martin, who I think was in the second safety car batch. So they're slightly out of sequence on the lap at the moment, because Maxime Martin's not done a proper flying lap since he's been released. But he's now been released, so the last lap was under the safety car, and the sectors are straight away a second and a half quicker in the first sector than Christopher Meese, and the best part of 3 seconds quicker in the second sector. The guy's just a star.
Yeah, but obviously all the other drivers will be explaining that they got held up in traffic, They could do that if they'd got the clear lap that he'd got, and that special little chassis tweak that he must have. It's probably called his right foot.
That'll be it. Yeah. All the excuses trotted out. So you've got BMW, Audi, 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 BMW, BMW, Audi, Ferrari 8th, Lamborghini 9th, Ferrari 10th. Number 52, the Nick Homerson car, we were told, was slow on track. It has got itself going again. Jamie Campbell-Walter has pitted. And they've got to open the door that was so badly vandalised by the Presley Spark Mercedes before the race started. And Jamie Campbell-Walter double stinting. Roel Gerton puts the money into that team single stint. Stuart Hall is the third driver in that car. That's 20th it is. Now, Frank Schnippler has got himself up past Christopher Meese, so a change for second place. Frank Schnippler going great guns, somebody who's as adept in modern GT cars as he is in historic sports cars. And there's number 30, the all-British Audi team. Phil Keane, Peter Belshaw, Craig Wilkins, Aaron Scott. They've had a couple of dramas in this race, being attacked by other cars, but just wanted to keep out of trouble and get to the finish, I think.
Saw a bit of TV for that earlier on, and in a short space of time, it seemed everybody just wanted to drive into that car, didn't
and
it?
And at the same corner.
Yeah. But they're in a hard time.
Strong car, the Audi. It has kept going. Number 12 has just been notified as a retirement, and that's a big frustration for Grégoire de Moustier, Duncan Tappy, Ulrich Amado and Mike Parisi, the car run by ART Grand Prix, the McLaren, that we've never really focused on because it was way back on the grid, had a stop-go penalty early on, and four good drivers in a good car out for the race. We'll try and get to the bottom of exactly why that is retired, but it's another McLaren in strife, whilst this seemingly bulletproof BMW just rumbles on at the head of the field. It's a great-looking car, and it's a great noise that BMW makes.
It's a really hard edge to it, isn't it? I'm not sure, but I guess it's a flat-plane crank engine on it. It's got a real hard edge to it. And I mean, the thing with that car, it's phenomenal in the centre section of the circuit. It's not the fastest car in a straight line by any means. But if you go and watch at Eau Rouge, when it was dry in qualifying, they were doing it flat. There was nobody else doing it. The car's stunning through there. And through the centre part, with a lot of change of direction, the car's so pointy. It's quite a short wheelbase car. So, with the Mercedes, is probably better in the fast corners because it's very long wheelbase. But it can be a little bit lethargic in where you really need to get the car on the nose. The BMW is a stunning car, though.
It's the leading car, and there's one fifth, there's one sixth, and increasingly teams starting to look for those cars. More flashing of headlights from the faster cars swooping down towards Eau Rouge, one of the Porsches, I think that is, trying to work its way past the Audi, out through Radion, up towards Le Combe once again. And all the time, drivers trying to not just drive their own race, but also work out that set of headlights behind. How close is it? That's the other thing to try to judge here. Up towards Le Combe come the cars, so it's still Martin ahead of Schnippel and Meese. Then you've got Sandstrom, Kettler, fifth. Stefan Lemmerich back behind the wheel in sixth place. There, number 16 is Frank Schnippler. That's the second place car. And he's lapping in the 2:48. His last lap was 3.6 seconds slower than Maxime Martin. It's just astonishing. Frank Schnippler is not slow by any means. And yet, Maxime Martin just is so fast in that car. And this is just what the team needs to try to build up the lead. Because every time he does it, out comes a safety car and it gets whittled away. But now he's pushing on once again.
Is that the same Schnippler that drives an Alfa in Historic?
Yeah. Alfa, Maserati, with Lucas. I'll remember his surname in a moment. But yes, he does go very well in Historics.
That's unlike you forgetting a name, Johan Arantxa.
I haven't forgotten, I just can't remember it. There's a subtle difference. Number 33, Porsche, out of the race. That was the car that arrived on fire a little while ago. And the fire extinguished, but that now goes faster than the Porsche. The little tow truck.
He looked quite happy to be retired, didn't he?
Yeah. Well, there's a concert that beckons, you know. Speaking of which, I need to let you go and have your walk around the circuit, don't I, now?
Yes, I'll go in a minute. Yeah, I'm actually quite enjoying watching it from in there on the TV. It's quite good fun.
I was hoping it might rain again. I can send you out in the rain. But it's a great shame that your Mercedes is out of the race, Mark, I have to say, because on the evidence of last year and of the way that Bernd Schneider was going with it, it was going to be good. But strangely this year, collectively, the Mercedes don't seem to be a factor in the Pro-Am class, because either it's different teams or different drivers in them this year, but they're not making the impact that we saw last year.
No, and it should be a great car for it. You know, it suits this circuit well. Its reliability is fantastic, generally. You know, the car's very strong. You look at all the suspension, it's built as an endurance car. Probably it's not the best car for, say, doing British GT, where you want more of a sprint race car, and I think a BMW or a Porsche would still be the car you'd take of choice for that. But it should be fantastic for that. And they've had different problems. You know, the Black Falcon car is a gear selection problem. That they had it play up on the way to the grid. They changed the little actuator on the air shifter, and that didn't do it, and so they were changing the gearbox. Did that actually get back out or not? Did they... I've not seen if they went back out. But it's different. It's different problems. So, No, unfortunately, the car hasn't covered itself in glory this week.
And yet, last year, there it was, fighting for a podium in overall terms.
You know, last year, the only problem we had on that car, which is the same car, you know, Jones have got two, but this is the same car, was one stuck windscreen wiper motor that we just had to pull the windscreen wiper off. That was it.
It put in
1 litre of oil through the whole race and just fueled it and put tyres on. Obviously, you put brake pads in it, but there was not one single problem, and the car has had a lot done to it for this one. It's a brand new engine in it, a brand new gear, but you know, it's they take it very seriously, as everybody does in this paddock. You can't come to this with an ill-prepared car, and it's the last thing you would have expected on that one to have been this.
The McLaren I was talking about a moment ago, Duncan Tappy's car, apparently had a fire in the pit lane, so the damage that has done has put pay to that McLaren. So 66 cars started this, 235 drivers went to the driver's briefing. It must have been like a football crowd. And we're getting quite through this entry. We're not going to get that many finishes on this event.
No, it's... Tappy, an interesting one there, isn't he? Because he's been damn quick all year in that car journey. Yeah. That car hasn't really figured as you would have expected through the whole weekend.
No, it's really weird, isn't it? And Duncan particularly has done a good job moving from single-seaters into GT racing, trying to sort of kick-start his career that's been forgotten about a bit.
He looks absolutely just to have found a new home doing it, doesn't he? I'm sure he's opened a few people's eyes through what he's done in Blancpain this year.
Absolutely right. So, fingers crossed for two more races, Nürburgring and Navarra, before the end of the year, that he will be able to get that car going strongly again. Out on track, still some great battles for Ray John, and Maxime Martin continues to lead the way. He is, again, 3 seconds a lap quicker than his opposition. Number 50, Rafael Giammaria, has just pitted out of the Pro-Am class lead, so that does now put the Lamborghini of Mark Hayek, the Blancpain CEO, back into the lead of the class. And then third in the class is Nick Homerson, and he's going to get himself up one place in the class as well, despite his dramas being slow on track a little while ago. And also creeping into the picture, number 75, Mark Henerici. The best placed Porsche is 11th. I want to ask Mike about this, Mike Jordan, because he specialises in not just preparing Porsches, but multiple Porsche champion a few years ago. And Porsches seem to be struggling again at the moment in this category.
Yeah, I mean, the GT3R should be as good as virtually anything else out there. You know, they've moved that car on over the last couple of years. It's got paddle shift on the steering wheel and all the bits that the other cars have got, but it doesn't quite seem to be there with some of the other stuff. I was just looking there, you know about Martin being so much quicker. You just look at generally how much faster he is than the top six cars there. It's not the sort of 2 or 3 seconds. He's 5 seconds faster than a lot of the other big names out there. It's quite phenomenal, right?
It is. It really is. And you can understand why Mark VDS so keen to keep hold of him and why he's in demand, starting racing prototypes now, of course. He's at Le Mans again this year. And we've got the third-place car of Frank Schnippler in the pit lane. You've also got the fourth-place Audi of Edward Sandstrom. That's a lap back coming in. And so down the pit lane have come the cars from third and fourth. Nick Homerson is in as well, as we've gone past now the 11:30 p.m. mark. There goes number two rejoining. That, as far as I could work out, was just fuel, keeping Edward Sandstrom behind the wheel. And away now goes Frank Schnippler. So they've not changed places on the pit stops because they're a lap apart of one another. But number 16, Frank Schnippler, heading now back into the race. There's the number 14 Mercedes. That car was in the walls early on. Koen Wouters being attacked by BMWs and knocked into the gravel, and it affected the handling of that car. But that should be a quick car because Koen Wouters is fast. Anthony Kumpen, who has won this race before, is another of the drivers in it. So he is rapid, as we know.
I was amazed that actually got out of the gravel, because I saw it get fired off into there, and then it was suddenly coming out, because normally that obviously the car's got a big flat bottom underbelly carbon on there, and I thought it would be bottomed out on that, so I think he did a good job to get out there. How long was Christensen's car after that incident? How much time did he lose in the pits?
The Audi, yeah. It was the best part of half an hour, so it was a very, very long delay. I mean, it was way, way down at the end of the first hour in 60-something place, you know, it was almost game over from that point on. Although it's crept its way back up the order, it was a very, very long stop that it had. So where it had got itself to now is 43rd. It's creeping back up the order. A win's out of the question, but it's going to be top 20, I thought, by the end of the race if it carries on without any further dramas. That's the other thing, isn't it? You never know what's around the corner for you.
No, and it's hard. Okay, half an hour, you can go for it. In our situation down there, we sort of initially tried to fix our car quickly in the pit lane, then put it back in the garage, and it gets to half an hour, and you think, okay, and you're looking at where you're dropping back to. And then the guys from Mercedes were working with... It's a bit of a joint effort this week. There's some of my touring car guys from Eurotech. There's Pyro's guys that sort of maintain the car regularly. And everybody's in there trying different things. And you get to sort of being 40, 45 minutes down, and you actually start to question, what are we going to achieve?
Yes.
And after sort of an hour, I sat with David and Godfrey, and I said, right, you've got to look at the risk-reward on this. Obviously, you know, once you're here and you've paid your entry fees and you've done everything like that, all you're going to save by not being in the rest of the race is your tyres and your fuel and a little bit of brake pads. But in conditions like this, if you're really going to push on, you're taking a few risks all the time. And I said, you know, you need to make the decision, is this worthwhile? And lots of other guys will have to do the same thing. Are you going to go back out there? And once you start being 20, I think at that point we were 24 laps behind. And they said, look, even if we fixed it, there's no point, because all we're doing is going and driving around and burning fuel and tyres. We're never going to get back to challenge for a podium.
No.
So,
no. It's a great shame, but this is a car that so far looks absolutely bulletproof. Maxime Martin making his way up over the timing line, and that puts 141 laps in the book of the 2012 Total 24 Hours of Spa, the 64th running of this race. And Maxime, who has yet to win it, his father has won it four times, and the way things are going, you wonder whether or not it can be the dream run. So far, so good. They've been in the right place at the right time to lead the race off the start, to be in the lead at the 6-hour mark and get the points. And that lap was only a 2:47. But even so, it is a fair bit quicker than anybody else out there.
Yeah, still, it's 2.5 seconds faster than me, and then the rest of the cars behind that are in 50, 53, 52. So it's sometimes you just get a feeling for a way a car's going and the way a race is almost panning out for it, don't you? And it just looks that they've got all their bases covered at the moment.
Exactly right. And in terms of pit stop time, the number three and the number one car, they've made the same number of stops, and they're not much apart in terms of the amount of time that they spent in the pit lane. So it's only a handful of seconds between the pair of them. It's going to be very evenly matched, this. And the BMW, which is only in its second Spa 24 hours, of course, there's a huge amount of development in the Audis. Still, I think, shaping up to be a real fascination. And Marcus Palter has yet to get into this car, so we've yet to see what he can do in it and in these conditions, and he's yet to take his penalty. So that's something else that needs to be factored in. Now, we have Bas Linders, of course, as one of the drivers of number three. Bas watching how Maxime Martin's getting on. He's in the pits with Hayley.
Bas, you guys are certainly still looking strong. Yourself and Max have really put it in the effort. And Marcus has yet to sit in the car. Are you any idea when he might get in?
Well, not yet. We see. I will be in next, so I will push again. Hopefully, we can extend a little bit more the lead, so we can put Marcus in and have his penalty without losing any points at the 12-hour mark. I think that's very important for the championship. Okay, for Marcus it's not so nice, but he's a good team player, and it's the best for the team. It's a penalty which, well, we think we did not deserve, and we do everything to try and minimize the effect of it.
You've certainly got a strong presence around the paddock here at your home track. You've got many supporters here wanting you to do well.
Yeah, we get more and more supporters every year, and it's because Mark van der Straaten, he really likes to run the team as a family, and also we like to be close to the fans, so we try to do a lot of things for the fans, and I think that's very important. So it's nice to see that they follow us, and that they come and they buy our caps and our shirts, t-shirts, etc. Because you see more and more Mark VDS in the paddock, and that's really nice.
Thank you, Bas.
So Bas Linders, the team principal, the player manager really for Mark VDS Racing, will get back into the car shortly. Marcus Palsen had yet to get behind the wheel of that car. We've got another yellow flag out because car number 70 now has ground to a halt out on the circuit. And the yellow flag is being shown because of the race art BMW. We talk about one bulletproof BMW, the race art car that was going strongly early on, particularly when Nick Katzberg was behind the wheel of it. That has stopped at turn 14, which is down at campus, just coming out of the pit path, that short straight down to the right-hander. And that's the corner that Koen Wouters' Mercedes ended up in the gravel, and it stopped out on the circuit. There it is. So
that 70 stopped at T14. We have yellow flags out there.
The race director, Eduardo Freitas, you heard in the background, talking that the car is off the road and the yellow flags are out. And it was being driven at the time by Roger Grauvels, the Dutch amateur racer. And whether he's had to pull off or had a moment and gone off, Mike Jordan, it was rather hard to see from that.
I think he'd probably pulled off there. It looked like it was just a trail across the grass to where he parked. He'd obviously got still electrics, he'd got lights still on, his front lights were still on, so gotta say that's probably something mechanical, driveline or engine wise that's parked in there.
Disappointed that, because the car had been going pretty strongly. So number 70, by the look of it, is going to be out of the race as the number 3 BMW then continues to hold sway. Maxime Martin, the race leader, and here at Spa the drivers battle into the night. The fans try to work out whether it's time for dinner or time to go to a concert. And Mike Jordan, who's been with me in commentary for the last few minutes, has promised himself a walk around the circuit. So probably now is your chance, isn't it, to go and enjoy the sights and sounds and the ambiance of Spa?
Absolutely. I'd rather be driving around the circuit, but I think I'll be a proper anorak and go and walk around it. I still think that BMW's got I think it's got everything covered, and I'll be surprised if that's not right there at the end. I think it's a fantastic car. I was just chatting to Andy before I came up here, and he said, if you could choose, he said, if we could get Pirtek to sponsor a GT car for us, what would it be? I said, it would be one of those BMWs. I'd love that in Pirtek blue with yellow wheels, but I think we'll not be able to manage that for a while.
Not for a year or two, maybe.
No, maybe not. It would be a bit of a dream for me doing that. Anyway, it's been an absolute pleasure. I think it's a fantastic race, and it'll be interesting to see what the morning brings.
Mike Jordan, it's a great shame you're not still in the race, but thanks for coming to join us, and good luck for the rest of the season in Blancpain for you and the Joneses, and for Andrew Jordan in the British Touring Car Championship, which is back at Snetterton in a couple of weeks' time. As down into the pit lane comes car number 1, Christopher Meese at the wheel of the Audi. And if they're going to do a driver change, then he'll hop out, but he's going to stay behind the wheel. So Christopher Meese double stinting, having taken the car over from Christopher Hasser. Stefan Ortelli will be the next driver through in the rotation. And the fueling is done. They're going to keep it on that set of tyres by the look of it, and therefore make it a shorter pit stop. Board moved away, seamless, all choreographed to perfection. Everybody knows exactly what they're doing, no fluster at all, just a quick slick pit stop, and the car rejoins the race. It may lose, should lose in fact second place on that to Frank Stippler, but the Audi rejoins. We sort of got this yellow flag out on the circuit because of the number 70 BMW that needs to be retrieved, and as it does so, the battle in the Pro-Am class now is between Mark Hayek, and working into contention as well is car 34, which has got Nicola Armindo at the wheel of the Pro GT by Almera Porsche. Nicola Armindo second in his class at Le Mans this year, and now starting to close on Mark Hayek. So Frank Stippler, number 16, turns his way through in second spot, having on the pit stop got back ahead of Christopher Meese. And this is how it's all going to pan out over the remainder of the race, I think. As people pit, then you kind of get the order shuffled, and it's only at the very end where people make that last pit stop that we're going to be able to work out what the race order is. So with the race now having lap 144, these different strategies that the teams are on because of when they've made the pit stops, some out of sequence of others, it all adds to the intrigue of the race. And so now, as the emergency vehicle there attends to the number 70 BMW, as soon as that's moved out of the way, then fingers crossed we can get a green flag, and that part of the circuit should be clear once again. So for Roger Cravels and the race art team, big disappointment with that car now seemingly being a retirement, and the BMW that was in the wall earlier when Jaap van Lagen went off the road had recovered well. Jaap van Lagen, in fact, after that spin, is now down in the pit lane and can explain what's happened to that car to Hayley.
Yeah, can you give us an update on car number 70?
Yeah, number 70, our car
He told us on the radio he had a crash in turn 14, and he's next to the track, and the truck will pick up him, so that means we are out of the race. That's really bad, because we are the whole race between 10 and 18, and top 6, 7, 8 in our class. We went really well, without any troubles, and now it's finished, so that's really poor.
Thank you.
Yeah, big disappointment, because the race art car, over the course of the season, in fact, has got stronger and stronger and was looking good. Yeah, Van Lagen, a very quick driver, both in terms of one make saloons. He had a spell for Lada in the World Touring Car Championship, ex-single-seater racer. And Nick Katzberg, we know, is a very fast driver as well, and he had done a good stint in that car. So, collectively, it was all looking good for a decent result, I reckon, in Pro-Am. But, not to beat, the car is out. And there you've got, in the pit lane, the Karimoje McLaren, a car that he's been sharing in this race with Ricardo Bravo, with Pedro Lamy and Luis Silva, a regular driver in the GT Open Championship. So he's got that yellow flag out on track. And the Frank Stippler Audi up into second spot. Now he's still not on a Maxime Martin pace, so Frank Stippler needs to try and find some time somewhere out of that car. But, of course, it's not just about Maxime Martin in number three. Marcus Paltola has proved in early rounds of the championship to be quick, but not as quick as Bas Linders or Maxime Martin. So when he's behind the wheel of the car, it'll still be fast, but not as fast, and therefore that's going to just change the complexion of the race even more. We've yet to see Paltola in the car because of this penalty he needs to take. And are they going to run it to 12 hours, I wonder, and not put him in it at all? Marcus Paltola touched on that when he spoke to Hayley Coxon earlier on in the race. And if that is the case, then he's going to have to really earn his corn in the second 12-hour element of the race. He's going to have a very busy Sunday, as he put it, because he needs to give the other guys a break and make sure that they don't do more driving than is permitted under the regulations. But it's a tough one, because you can only do a maximum amount in one go, and there is a limit to how much driving the others can do also. So the team need to factor all that in. So maybe risking it to only putting him in the car after 12 hours is too much of a gamble. In the meantime, Maxime Martin there sliding the car through the pit path, leading the way. Frank Stippler runs second, Christopher Meese runs third, fourth is Kechler, fifth is Sandstrom, and in sixth place, number 40, Greg Gilbert in the Santiloc Audi. It's down the pit lane now comes the Ferrari, which I think is a Kessel Racing car, number obscured. Refueling starts. Driver change. 71, which is the Pro class Kessel Racing car, has really, as I said earlier on, been a disappointment in this race, having struggled for speed, struggled for good position, race long, and continues to struggle as the race now gets to just over 16 hours to go. The leader into the bus stop. Maxime Martin about to power his way up past the pits. As he does so, this will be the end of lap number 145 for him. Goes through, and the lap that he does is a 2:47.1. That's a sort of Stippler pace, not just because he was doing earlier. But he's coming towards the end of this stint. Tire degradation is something that we've heard from Rob Bell earlier on. One of the quotes from the pit lane is that tire degradation is something that people have been suffering with, but you have to adapt to it. In the dry conditions, of course, right at the start of the race, when he got into the lead and he had a clear track in front of him, Maxime Martin did the best lap of the race. In the dry, he was doing 2:21s. So it shows you that in the damp, greasy conditions that we have now and in the dark, they're 26 seconds or so slower than that. But Maxime Martin has got the best lap of the race to his credit, continues to lead the way. And at the moment, it's looking very hard to stop that car. But I still think things will look different when you get Marcus Paltola in and you factor in his pace. And Marcus Paltola will take over the car when the team is content. But Maxime Martin, with his charmed life, how he managed to avoid a major drama when Mike Wainwright's McLaren moved across on him, it's something of a mystery. But Maxime managed to back out of that just at the right moment. Down to Grisselli comes now. Through that right-hander, running downhill, powering his way on this, the 146th lap of the race. Now, last time around, Frank Stippler lap quicker, in fact, than did Maxime Martin. Doesn't bring the gap down hugely, but it's interesting that on the right lap with the right track conditions and a lack of traffic, Frank Stippler can rise to the challenge here. There in the pit lane, while he's limbering up,
kind of limbering up and ready to go swimming, perhaps, given the conditions. Better than it was, so I don't think swimming is quite so important anymore. So, Bas Lined is ready to take the car over. Leave Maxime Martin. There, in the background, is the Roger Crowell's BMW, still being attended to, but for as long as you know Jaap van Lagen say that it has to be brought back to the pits on the truck, then that's out of the race. The race currently then, lap 146 for the leader. And with cars coming out of Blanchimont, it was here earlier where we had big shunt for Philippe Seligny, who was taken to hospital for x-rays, suffering from bruises and a bit of concussion, but the good news is nothing more serious than that. It was a big whack, but again proved the strength of modern day GT cars, and the roll cage and all the safety equipment in the car, so he will stay in hospital overnight, we're led to believe, but it's really for observation more than anything more serious than that. But it was a big impact, so quite rightly goes to hospital for x-rays, and he'll hopefully be back at the circuit tomorrow to watch the finish. You just saw number 88 McLaren go through Lesseurs. Alvaro Parent at the wheel of the car, running in 15th place, working his way up the order. The car having lost ground early on, collectively over a few pit stops, and with drivers of different speed in the car. Chris Goodwin, part of the McLaren development programme for the GT car. Chris, who's hugely involved in the McLaren GT project, he has had his spell at the wheel of the car, so too has Roger Wills. Chris Goodwin, the chief test driver from McLaren Automotive, to give him his full title, but a hugely experienced racer before he took on the McLaren role. He's been in the car, so has Roger Wills, and Alvaro Parent being taken over from Rob Barth, getting himself now back up the order. Into the pits has come 66, Frank Kettler. This car is creeping back into the picture. It's still got a lap to make up on the leader, but it shouldn't be ignored, and Frank Kettler has brought it in. It lost out after an extra pit stop to change tyres and a slow pit stop when it got caught behind the slow 73 Ferrari. And another stop-go penalty for a driving stint violation is about to be given to number 59. And this is the Ferrari for Vita 4-1. Alessandro Bonetti, Andrea Ciccato, Michael Lyons and Philippe Salaquada at the collective helm, if you like, of that car. Now trying to work out which of the drivers it is that's gone too far in that car. Salaquada is shown behind the wheel of it at the moment, but if it is Philippe Salaquada, again, it's the team that needs to be on top of when drivers get in, and I think, to be fair, it will not be Salaquada, it will be somebody earlier on in the rotation of this, because the message has to get through to the team. The team manager has to come and see the stewards, a decision has to be taken, then the penalty is issued. So if you go back in time, it may well have been Ciccato who was the last driver in that car, and it could have been him, I think, but was the driver that had the transgression. So 59 gets this drive-through penalty. Maxime Martin turning his way through traffic, working his way past the slower cars, and as he does so, he continues to be lapping quicker than Frank Stippler, therefore building that lead. And he's not far off another pit stop. If Bas Lined is ready, as we've now seen, then won't be long, I think, before the number 3 BMW is back down into the pit lane. So we are at 10 minutes to midnight here. There is Bas Lynders ready to go. And, of course, what we have now looks very different indeed from the start of the race, when the cars blasted away from the line here at Spa at 4 o'clock Saturday afternoon. This was how it looked, an all BMW front row, with a good getaway being made by Frank Kettler, but not as good as that of Maxime Martin, who made his move on the inside for the first part, the outside for the second part of Eau Rouge, and took the lead as the cars climbed onto the Camel Straight for the third time, being chased by Alvaro Parent, and going with them, Nico Verdonk, Andre Lotterer trying to work his way through traffic, dispensing with the Stefan Lemre BMW, and almost tagging the back of Bent Schneider in the Mercedes. One driver who had been tagged was Olivier Pla, suffering rear damage in the 83 Porsche. Battles lower down between Ferrari and McLaren, drivers using all of the curve in their efforts to try and stave off the opposition. The Porsche drivers in the Cup class, being aware of the speed differential of their cars compared to the GT3 newer brigade out of the Gentleman Trophy class, indicating how they should be negotiated, whilst Uwe Altsen with the very latest Porsche running in the Pro-Am class, hustling on, getting himself onto the tail of Peter Cox. Matt Griffin was also running well despite the bonnet catch having broken and the car losing a good amount of straight line speed, as Xavier Martin worked his way up the order, moving himself past the Olivier Plat Porsche, swinging through Licon. Frank Kettler was doing his level best to stay on the back of the leading car as he turned his way out of La Source. And then Jaap van Lagen got it wrong at Licon. The race art BMW slithering off into the tyre barrier. Thankfully, no major harm done, and the car was able to rejoin, although Jochen Habetz's move on Koen Wouters spelled disaster for both. The Mercedes into the gravel, and Habetz heading to the pit lane with a punctured tyre. Wouters got out of the gravel, he headed back to the pit lane, although the car would soon be back in with damaged suspension. André Lotterer tried to make a move on Bertrand Baguette coming out of Licon, but he couldn't do it. The Aston Martin driver hung onto the pace around the outside, and the double Le Mans winner in the Audi had to sit content behind the Aston as they headed downhill. Wouters, after his pit stop, discovered that the car still wouldn't handle. He ran wide, going through Brussel. Tony Villander was holding up the race leader. He wouldn't get out of the way to be lapped. But then it all kicked off at the bus stop as Adam Christodoulou made a late dive for the pit lane, chopped across the front of the André Lotterer-driven Audi, and Christodoulou bounced into the barriers. And that put that car not out of the race, but out of contention with damaged suspension. It also ruined the chances of the Lotterer Audi because that had damaged front left as well. Lorenzo Bontempelli had a punctured tyre and lit the Ferrari back towards the pit lane. And Frank Kekele came across traffic, making his way up towards the bus stop. As ahead of him, Lorenz Frey was tapped into a spin. Thankfully, there was just room enough for Kekele to squeeze by. The Jaguar was able to rejoin, but ultimately had an electrical problem and was going to be out of the race. Christopher Mies, Christopher Hasser and Stefan Ortelli's Audi in the second stint becoming more of a threat as it worked its way up the order, and Uwe Altsen was storming past anything that was ahead of him, being a bat marker or a car that he was having a fight for position with. He got past Edward Sandstrom going towards Licon as David Jones, having relieved Bernd Schneider in the Mercedes, was mugged by the Jochen Habetz BMW coming out of Licon. Dramas also for Jeffrey van Hooijdonk as he clipped the United Autosports Audi. The GT3 Racing GT3 got involved with a Pro GT Balmera Porsche. Edward Sandstrom lapped Kenneth Fire only to outbrake himself and run wide. Got the car back under control, found Eric van der Poel's McLaren right up behind him. Then there was Dramas. Peter Belshaw was savaged by the Pro Speed 74 Porsche of Maxime Soule. That turned him around in the same corner where the car had almost come to grief earlier. Edward Sandstrom was pushing on. He had Stefan Lemre behind him, and Frank Stippler in the number 16 Audi managed to get past the pair of them with a good run coming out of Radion. And by the time they got to Licon, he was ahead. Alvaro Parent tried to make a move on Eric van der Poel. That didn't pay off. Parent sat behind for another couple of corners, but then made his move going into the pit path and worked his way by on the inside line to pick up another place. And then problems for number 33, because the Porsche started to smoke, it caught fire, it dropped oil around the circuit, and as Eric Dermont brought the car into the pit lane, there's behind him one or two, such as Peter Cox and Eric van der Poel, were caught out by the oil on the road. Then the rain came with such volume as to catch out Julian Draper. He wasn't the only one. Phil Quaife arrived and went off. The yellow flags were waved, but still people spun. And in the end, with the Andrew Danilou BMW crashing on the pit straight and the amount of standing water, we had a very long safety car period. The Audi mechanics were ready to go swimming rather than anything else. When the conditions improved just a little, the safety car headed back to the pit lane. The race was back underway as the cars stormed their way over the line, with Andrea Puccini in a big hurry to try and catch up with the rest of them. He was running third, but wanted to get himself up onto the tail of the top two cars, namely the number three BMW, which soon pitted, and the number one Audi. As number three was in the pit lane, so the number one Audi took over the lead. It then pitted and handed the lead back again to the Mark VDS Racing BMW squad. And then Philippe Salini had this huge accident coming out of Blanchimont. It destroyed the front of the car, and it also meant that we had another safety car period, and Philippe Salini headed to hospital for observation. through into the lead. Under braking for the bus stop, though, came Christopher Hassel. He worked his way past Bas Linders. He put the Audi ahead of the BMW. And then the rain came once again. The safety car needed to be deployed, and everybody paddled round dutifully, waiting for conditions to improve. Improve they duly did. And when racing got back underway, there was yet more drama, because McLarens contrived to drive into each other down at La Source, with Klaus Hummel making a move against the car of Nico Verdonk. Two cars making contact and ending up in a dangerous place. But the circuit had been incredibly wet before that. The fireworks going off, adding to the ambiance of the Spa 24 Hours. And Frank Kekler avoided a narrow scrape with the United Autosports Audi as the two cars came to grief, or very nearly did so, rubbing bodywork. Another one that escaped disaster was Maxime Martin, because he got chopped by Mike Wainwright. Wainwright had a spin in the McLaren. Maxime Martin somehow got away with it. He was very lucky. The gap he was going for suddenly disappeared as Wainwright moved across, thinking the corner was earlier than it was. And this was the McLaren moment, as Klaus Hummel went to the inside of Nico Verdonk. Big whack between the two. It ripped a wheel off the Klaus Hummel car. Thankfully, that was avoided by everybody. It put two more cars out of the race. Then we had another safety car period when the number 73 Ferrari lost a wheel somehow, coming to pit in, and it blocked the pit lane entry. It needed removing. Number 16 Audi managed to get himself up in the second spot, and the number 3 BMW leads the way. Bas Linders now the man behind the wheel of it, as the concert is in full swing now here at Spa.